Are you searching for the best in online black radio? Then go to blacktalkradionetwork.com, helping you filter through the noise. Real talk, black talk.
The internet is full of half-truths and all-out lies. We've all seen them, and many people on social media complaining about it. Here's your chance to show improve. WorldAfropedia.com is a black-owned and operated encyclopedia. There are several thousand articles, but we need help. We can't uncover all the truth ourselves. So please, join us and become a writer, editor, or blogger for WorldAfropedia.com today. Every little bit counts. We owe it to the future generations to put the truth out there. Visit WorldAfropedia.com, the African-centered encyclopedia, a global database of African knowledge for the purpose of bringing about global African wisdom and understanding. WorldAfropedia.com.
John Robbie made a statement that he doesn't believe that black people can be racist. He said black people can be stupid, black people can be prejudiced, black people can be hypocrites, black people can be insulting. There can be a lot of things, but that they cannot be racist. And then I've been working hard to find an article that was written by Peter Bruce, another white man, who also made a similar claim a year or two ago before all of this kind of blew over. And I'm sorry, Peter Bruce, that I'm paraphrasing because I don't have your article in front of me. I filed it somewhere, but I don't have it. But the point that Peter was saying, was making, was a historical breakdown on the history of racism, where it started and what it was about. The superiority, the economic structure, the slavery, subjugating people to certain jobs and education levels, and domination. Is it dominion? Domination. What's dominion? Domination. Yeah. You can have dominion over certain nations, right? So that's also relevant. And the overall point he was making is nowhere in the world have black people done that. And I know it's a bitter pill to swallow because it's why are we talking about this again? But I think we have to. I think we must because these things keep creeping up. When somebody like the student, what's his name again, who posted about black K's and using the C-U-N-T-S word, he was interviewed by John Mathen yesterday. What's his name? Matthew Tiernison. I think a lot of people have reacted to that, but I have a different angle to it. Of course it is bigotry. Of course it is racism. And nobody can make you so angry that you become racist. You already are racist. And I just think I don't want to give him airtime. I don't want to give him airtime because it's just so exhausting. But there is something that he said that I do want to address. Listen carefully. There is something that he said that is the angle that I do want to address. I happen to agree with Peter Bruce and John Robbie, and that I believe that black people are a lot of things. But racism is about superiority. It is about my identity. I'm superior because of my identity, and you are inferior because of the color of your skin. And I grew up in a Soweto where every time a white person came through, it was like there's a party. You find people in the streets just going on there and praising the family that's been visited. You have white people visiting your home. So there isn't an inherent regard of white people as racist. What I'm seeing of black people, there isn't an inherent regard of white people as inferior. What I'm seeing now is that black people are reacting to the racism with their own form of anger and rage and prejudice and insulting comments and so on. But I don't believe that is racism. Racism is about power. Racism is about a system, and it's about what's being taught. It's about how society has been packaged and structured. And over the years, hundreds of years, it's been structured along the lines of a superior race and an inferior one. And I do not know of any instance where black people presided over that.
Me either. context of white supremacy. Gus T. Renegade in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. Today's date, Monday, June 13th, 2016. So I have been told, obviously, we are broadcasting much, much earlier than our normal broadcast time, but we always really make a commitment to discussing, talking, thinking about racism, white supremacy as a global problem. This is not something that is isolated to South Carolina or Mississippi or someplace in the South or South Africa. This is a worldwide system, worldwide problem. I think it's always great to hear how it operates in different parts of the globe. Thanks to folks who are able to tune in live, obviously, earlier in your Monday than our typical broadcast time. We'll be back tomorrow, normal broadcast time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. The audio clip that you heard at the beginning of the program, Cape Talk 702. We actually have listeners. We've had folks come on, participate in our global Sunday talk on racism in South Africa before. Some of the folks who listen in South Africa, where they have written, and sometimes they're talking as though I don't keep up with news, at least to some degree, about things happening in South Africa. They were even talking to me as though I didn't know who Trevor Noah is. I was like, come on, man. I knew who he was way before he got to Comedy Central, man. Come on. But the segment that you heard, Reedy Klabi, a big fan of her program. I've been listening to her for some years now. They were talking about the incident with Matthew Tienison. This is a white male in South Africa, I think about a month ago. He was upset. They made a decision about some of the athletic clubs. I think it was the cricket club and the football club, soccer, if you will. Basically, I think it was, unless I'm mistaken, I guess can, you know, correct me if I'm wrong, but unless I think my understanding is that they decided that they were not going to allow South Africa to host any of these major international sporting competitions because they had not done enough to fight against racism and have more inclusion of non-white players on the national teams in these respective sports. And this white male, Matthew Tienison, was furious. He went on social media and wrote this nasty, racist diatribe and called them Kaffirs, which is like the equivalent of nigger in South Africa, and black cunts and all this. And I believe just within the past few days, he got he agreed to do community service, making amends for his racist commenting online, if you will. But that's what she was talking about in that segment, where she was saying black people cannot be racist. This was a huge event in South Africa over the past 30 days. They were talking about this and writing about this and the whole nine. Our guest for the program today was in that number of folks who wrote about this incident and what it reveals about racism, what it means about white people specifically. The article that he wrote, "I'm a racist, but I'm trying my best to amend for that." One of our listeners saw it, thought it would be great to have him as a guest on the program. He agreed. Here we go. You can check out his website, www.caw.clark.com. That address again, www.caw.clark.com. It's linked in the description, and you can go right to the article that I just referenced. I'm a racist, but I'm trying my best to amend for that. Even though he was not born in South Africa, he has been writing, traveling, talking about racism on the continent for some time. He is joining us live from South Africa, our guest, Mr. Christopher Clark. Mr. Clark, are you with us, sir?
I am. Thank you, guys. Thank you for having me, and hello to the listeners.
For sure. Thank you for visiting with us on the program. I guess before we get started, anything that you think would be helpful for listeners to know about who you are, the work that you do?
Yeah, I mean, I can give just a brief introduction. So you kind of summed it up nicely, but I'm a journalist. I'm based in Cape Town in South Africa, but I work kind of all over the African, well, in various different parts of the African continent. I moved here about 6 years ago from the UK. And I kind of work as a travel journalist. But I'm always kind of looking at staying very aware of my position as a white Western male when I travel and the kind of connotations that it has in different parts of Africa and also just within South Africa. And yeah, I write on race and, as I said, travel and politics and conservation and kind of anything else that I think is important. But increasingly sort of things connected to race, I think, are kind of unavoidable in South Africa. And so I've sort of started to hone in on that quite a lot.
Mm, for sure. Unavoidable in the world, I would submit, but certainly in South Africa. You've already mentioned, just making sure everybody's clear, you are a white man.
Yes.
Right on. I guess before we even get started to the subject we wanted to talk about, I know here in the state, I'm just trying to get a sense of how big a phenomenon this is globally. Are folks talking about, have you heard about the shooting that happened in Orlando, Florida over the weekend here in the United States where 50 people were killed and more than that were gunned down? Is that something that has been big news in South Africa?
Yes, it has. Yeah. I mean, I think, you know, obviously, even when it isn't such a kind of massive news event, we do tend to have a pretty good grasp of US media and what's happening in the US here. I think there are often a lot of parallels between things that happen here and in the US. So I think generally people are pretty switched on to what's happening in the US. And definitely when it's such a kind of massive and terrifying and horrific event.
What's been, just from what you've heard and then your own thoughts in terms of how people are processing this event of terrorism, what's been said about it in the media coverage that you've seen so far?
I mean, to be honest, beyond the sort of bare bones of the story, I haven't read a huge amount. I personally find that a lot of the commentary that comes out is often not particularly constructive and just kind of makes me feel a bit depressed about the state of the world, because there's obviously a lot of hate that kind of comes out in the aftermath of these things. So I tend, just a personal approach, I'm not saying it's right, but my kind of personal approach is to wait for things to sort of simmer down a little bit and then to kind of really unpack all the stuff behind it. So as I say, kind of beyond the bare bones of the figures and what happened and how many people died, I really, it's not something I feel I can comment on particularly confidently, to be honest.
Okay. When you, in terms of, I guess you said hate being expressed thus far, where has this hate been directed?
Well, I think always that whenever there is any kind of terror attack, people are obviously very quick to, whether or not it's in any way connected, very quick to kind of jump on the Islamophobia bandwagon. And as somebody who, you know, is very much against that, I find it, yeah, I just find that I don't know how constructive it is to kind of delve into really kind of hateful, ignorant comments of that nature when it's still such a kind of raw topic and raw story. And I'd rather kind of just, yeah, give a bit of respect to the families of the victims by kind of even just on a personal level, giving them my own personal kind of peace.
Understood. I will say for listeners, as we're broadcasting, there is a television on in front of me, and they just rolled the names of the victims by, which I had not seen before. As you said, this is still very, very new, and details are still coming out and all that. At least from my initial glance, I certainly would have to do more research. It looked like a lot of names that people would generally associate with being, quote-unquote, Latino. And they said it was Latin night at the club, at the Pulse in Orlando, which to me might suggest that this might have, there might have been a large number of individuals who are classified as not white at this club, which would be an important bit of information. But obviously more of that will come out, particularly once I'm able to see photographs of what these people look like, if they release photos of the victims eventually. Thank you. Appreciated getting your thoughts on that. Moving forward, this program, speaking of terrorism, I have unfortunately concluded that we are in a global system of racism. I use the term racism and white supremacy as synonyms, and I use the same definition for both terms. The definition I use is as follows: a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
I'd say that was pretty definite in both cases. I think, you know, within South Africa and kind of as you said at the outset, I think all over the world, I would say that was pretty spot on. And I think that, you know, that's part of the, that's kind of the first step in, I suppose, a lot of the conversations that I'm trying to have and from what I know of what you're trying to do, is just getting everyone to kind of at least acknowledge that that system exists. I think the problem is so many people still don't, and until they do, it's very difficult to do anything about it. I completely agree with your definition and your kind of summation of that.
Right on. Question I've been trying to ask as many white people as possible, extra nice to be able to ask a white person who is outside the States. There was an article in a mainstream publication here right at the end of 2014, it's been about a year and a half, where it was a non-white author, and he was talking about white supremacy, and he has a sentence. The sentence reads, white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism, but rarely are they pained enough. And just with the first portion of that sentence, just your experience, the white people that you've been around, you're a white person yourself, your studies on race, do you think the first portion of that sentence is true? And this portion being white people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism. Just your experience, being honest, do you think that a sizable number of white people are sincerely and greatly pained by racism?
No. I think that, you know, I mean, I can't give you statistics, but I think some, definitely. A majority, probably not. You know, would a majority tell you that they are greatly and sincerely pained by racism? Probably yes. How many of them would actually mean it? I would estimate that would be a lot less. I don't know. I think it's... I think, as I said, we're probably coming to this later, but as I said in the article that you mentioned about Matthew Tennyson, I think being a racist has come to be seen as like kind of similar to being a rapist. It's this kind of the same, we see them the same in many ways. We see a racist as this kind of abominable human being, this kind of cave dwelling monster that none of us want to be in any way associated with. So I think we're very quick to kind of distance ourselves as much as possible from that, and would possibly to that end profess kind of profound and sincere sadness and hurt at instances of racism. But probably we don't even really acknowledge how or realize how genuine those sentiments might be and how much they're sort of motivated by a kind of defense mechanism to distance ourselves from this thing that we perceive a racist to be.
Wow, that some of that definitely will come up as we get to your post, but I thought your initial response, a clear no, you do not think a sizable number of white people are greatly, sincerely pained about racism. I agree completely, and that's why I've been trying to ask as many white people as possible, because I think it frequently when people discuss white supremacy, people are not honest. People are not honest. We're not accurate. And in my view, the transmission of concepts like that, getting people to think that there are a large number of white people that are really, really upset and troubled about racism, I think that is a part of why we have not been able to solve this problem. We need to be honest, accurate, and I've seen zero evidence that white people are sad, hurt, angry, disgruntled about racism at all. I have not, anywhere in the world, I have not seen that. And we should just be honest about that. That'll help us move things along to solving this problem. Before I move, there's so many current events, South Africa related as well. Oscar Pretorius, the resentencing is popping up as we speak. Literally, I saw that earlier today. Like, oh, wow, how fortuitous. We can bring that up as well, because that for sure relates to racism. And the Olympics are on the horizon as well. For folks who don't remember, Oscar Pretorius, white male. He was nicknamed Blade Runner, double amputee. He was at the 2012 Olympics in London. He got so much attention. And then he shot and killed his wife, Reva Steadkamp, I hope I'm saying her name correctly. She was in the bathroom at his residence. He claimed that he thought it was a burglar, because we certainly have lots of black thieves in South Africa. He thought it was some burglar who had gotten the house, and so he fired. He didn't realize it was his partner, Reva, and shot and killed her. They had the trial with a black judge, no less, black female. He was convicted. He got what many people thought was a very light sentence. Now they're doing the whole resentencing because a lot of people were very upset with the sentence that he got. I think his white father even came out at the time and made some racist comments about, again, how you have so many black criminals and black thieves. I mean, of course, you'd be frightened and on edge and having to defend yourself with all these, you know, conniving coffers around, running around South Africa. Have you been paying attention? And even the report that I saw today, they were saying that he is suffering from severe depression and is not fit to take the stand. Do you have any thoughts on how all of this has transpired and what does this reveal about racism, white supremacy in South Africa, specifically with Oscar Pretorius?
Yeah, I mean, I think the Oscar Pretorius story, the whole thing, kind of from start to finish and all the various different developments, you know, many people have sort of seen it and looked at it in as a kind of microcosm of like the sort of race issue in South Africa and kind of white fear and all of these kind of ideas. And I think, you know, it does in many ways play into that. And you can see, as you said, Oscar's dad did come out and kind of publicly defend him, saying that, you know, yeah, there was this huge issue with black crime. There were many other white people that kind of initially at least sided with him in that regard. And I think subsequently, as it looked more and more like it was in no way, you know, a crime that was motivated by his fear, but a crime of anger and, you know, whatever it was, something to do with him being directly angry at Reva, not something that was a mistake, then obviously I think that kind of changed. But I think even now, you know, there are all sorts of different aspects that came out of it. Another one was at the same time that Reva was actually initially killed, there was a Cape Townian woman, a South African woman of color, who was 17, who was killed in a horrendous situation, raped and gang raped and murdered by a group of guys within her community, one of whom was her boyfriend. It was horrendous, absolutely brutal, brutal murder. And just looking at the disparity in the kind of coverage that the one story got versus the other, I think, you know, that also says a lot about the kind of the kind of problematic attitude to race in South Africa, where, you know, it's okay for a black woman to be mutilated and killed and cast aside, but heaven forbid it could happen to a white woman, you know. So that was another aspect of the kind of racist system that really played out with that story, I think. And as I say, a lot of this stuff is kind of coming back again now.
Do you recall, unless I'm misinformed, there, when people were upset about the sentencing, there was a lot of that directed at the black female judge, who was like she's old enough that she was a victim of like the formal apartheid white supremacist regime in South Africa. Do you recall some of that fury being directed at her?
Yeah, I think it was. And I think there was a lot of negative commentary about the judge that sort of became linked to her race, and I think that was just, you know, a flawed way of looking at it from the beginning. I think you know, in these kind of situations, you have to be looking at the ability of a judge based purely on the sentence that they've made, and I think in something like the courts, where everything is about, you know, a fair trial and whatever, at least in theory, the same should be kind of applied to a judge, where, like, I don't think her race should really have become a factor in that story. Personally, I don't think it was relevant to that story.
Hmm. I guess even extrapolating in a more general sense, not just Oscar Pistorius, but and you're not, again, you're not, you were not born in South Africa. You've been traveling throughout the continent and what have you. But just your studies, the time that you spent there, do you get a sense that white people, generally speaking, are authentically, sincerely afraid of black people in South Africa?
Yes, absolutely. I think that I would, you know, again, I don't have statistics to draw on, so I'm just kind of going on my gut feeling and what I notice and what I hear and what I read. So, you know, forgive me for generalizing, but I think definitely, yes, as a generalization, I would say that most white people in South Africa are essentially terrified of black people.
Wow. What, I guess, how was that manifested? Like, how was that, what exactly bits of evidence do you pick up on that suggests this fear of black people, terror of black people, if you will?
Well, I think a very easy one for me is just the unwillingness of white people to ever be in a so-called black space, if you want to call it that. I mean, in Cape Town, you know, Cape Town is a very segregated city still, and you have township areas with what I suppose you could kind of call ghettos. I don't know the sort of terminology that you would use in the States necessarily, but here we call them townships. They're the kind of formerly areas that were formerly set up for black and colored citizens of South Africa to kind of remove them from the white areas. You know, and these areas are still essentially free of white people. And I know a handful of white people who would ever consider going there, whether or, you know, whatever might be, you know, you could. I often go there for work. I often go there because I also have friends there. And I think that it is important to kind of try and bridge the gaps when you can, on the one hand. But on the other hand, there's also, you know, often, for example, like there's some really cool jazz venues that are in the townships, just as one example. So I often go to these areas and I find that most people I know, even the kind of young, liberal, open-minded South Africans, are very, very reluctant to go into any of these spaces because of fear of crime, fear of, you know, of being unwelcome, fear of sort of animosity towards them as a white person, fear of all kinds of different things, just fear of the sort of big unknown thing that they still see black people as in South Africa.
What would your response be to folks who say, hey, there's still an astronomical wealth disparity in South Africa, one of the largest in the world in terms of the access to resources, including firearms, that white people have in South Africa as opposed to what black people have, and that even though white people are greatly outnumbered, at least the statistics I've seen, I think South Africa is about 80% black, give or take, so they are vastly outnumbered, white to black people, and then white to non-white population in total is certainly, but they don't. For folks who would say that there's nothing logical, there's no logical reason for white people to be fearful of black people since they have all the resources and they have the guns and, you know, they largely control directly, indirectly, the political institutions, the police and what have you, there's really no reason for them to be afraid. What would your response be?
No, I mean, you know, but if we're talking about racism, and as I'm sure you know, like, racism isn't logical. You know, none of this stuff is logical. People can try to find logical ways to define it. And, you know, obviously one of the simplest ways that people might do that is just saying, oh, but if you look at the majority of crime, it is committed by black people. And you can say, well, you know, that's pretty obvious because the majority of people are black. And, you know, obviously also in South Africa, and I think to a degree this is the same anywhere in the world, but just speaking about South Africa, you know, the relationship between race and class are very close in South Africa. So, and crime worldwide tends to be worse in kind of socially, in areas that are socioeconomically disadvantaged. And in South Africa, those areas happen to be, because of the history, predominantly black and colored. So, you know, to have this sort of fear and to try to back up this stuff with sort of statistics about the amount of crime that is caused by black people, it's also just a really thin argument, even if you try to make it a logical one. But I mean, aside from the kind of thin layers of statistics that you can use underneath it all, it is completely illogical. And I tend to go more on first-hand experience than on statistics personally. And I know that I often feel safer, feel more welcome, and feel that more people are looking out for me when I'm in a so-called black area or black space than I do in many white spaces in Cape Town, because in the white spaces, everyone's locking themselves behind big high walls. And if you're sort of out on the street, you're kind of potentially on your own if something goes down. And there's a good chance that even if somebody's there and, you know, they see something happening, they're going to be too sort of caught up in their own fears to do anything to help. In many of the black areas that I spend time in Cape Town, you'll find that as soon as you go there, people will be like, hey, how are you doing? What are you up to here? Oh, you know, can I walk you to where you're going? Do you know where you're going? And people are very willing to help, and people are very happy to see outsiders. And it's not just erasing. They're happy to see people come from other areas in their space, and will do what they can to kind of make you feel at home there. And I've been in a township, Khayelitsha, which is one of the biggest townships in Cape Town, which if you looked it up on the internet, it's probably just going to tell you, you know, how much gun crime is there, how many gangs are there, how much rape happens there. I've been there at 4:30, 5 o'clock in the morning with me and one other guy with a huge video camera walking around in the streets in the dark. And I felt considerably safer there than I have done doing the exact same thing in the predominantly white area where I live at the same time in the morning, just as one example. So it is completely illogical.
That right there, in my opinion, is pretty stunning illustration of the power of white supremacy, in my opinion, given the history of things that have happened in South Africa worldwide, but certainly South Africa. Why do you think you, as a white person, being in an area that is notoriously, whether it's correct or not, but notoriously branded as being super violent and full of criminals and thugs and what have you, why is it that you think you, as just one white person, not, you know, your own private band of security forces to keep you safe and not being armed to the teeth with all sorts of firearms and what have you, that you could be in that area and be totally safe, in fact, and be more welcome than you are in white areas? Why do you think that is?
It's hard to say. I mean, I think that, you know, in South Africa, I think there are certain ideas, for example, about certain black South African cultures where, you know, there's this, I don't know if you're familiar with this or not, but there's this sort of concept, and there are different variations of this all across Africa, but in South Africa they call it Ubuntu, which essentially is this kind of theory. You know, they kind of say in Western theory, I think, therefore I am, and in Ubuntu theory it's kind of like I am because of others. So it's this sort of communal ideal. And I think that that does sort of pervade many black South African cultures to a degree. So I think that it is often just part of the culture that people will kind of go out of their way to welcome you. I think it's also partly something that is necessitated sometimes by the surroundings. So because many people in the townships are in a pretty tough situation, they kind of have to band together. So their whole sort of life becomes about sort of helping each other out, because otherwise you would, you know, it'd be a much bigger struggle. And so anyone else that steps into that space, there's already that kind of philosophy of helping each other out. But I think it's also because, as Reedy Tlabi, who I love, by the way, kind of says in that clip, you know, that there isn't this sort of, racism isn't a black thing in the same way. So, you know, if I'm one black guy and I step into a white space in Cape Town, and I know this from friends, you know, it's often a very uncomfortable situation, because all of these fears, all of this sort of this racist kind of indoctrination sort of comes into play. And that doesn't happen in black spaces. I don't walk into a black space and find people looking at me going, hey, what's this guy doing here? You know, maybe he's up to no good. There isn't any of that. So I'm also kind of aware that, like, I'm probably, you know, it's sort of not necessarily fair. Well, no, it's definitely not fair that I am treated so well essentially in these areas without doing anything kind of necessary to merit that, just by pure virtue of there being a very different attitude from black people towards white people than vice versa.
Very important usage of the word fair on this program for CO.W.S. listeners. Mr. Clark, do you think one of the central reasons that you are treated so well and are safe even at 4 or 5 o'clock in the morning in these areas is that you are seen as a representative of white power, even as a single individual? Even the clip that you heard Reedy Klobby, who I'm a big fan of as well, where she said when a white person comes in an area, it's, oh my gosh, you have white people in your area, or there's a white person there. Oh my gosh, that's great. Not seen as something to talk bad about, but something almost to be proud. Like, wow, look at you. This is something where you are moving up the social ladder because you have white people that are coming to visit you, and that in the system of white power, number one, if they did something to you, that there is a power structure to respond to that, where maybe it will be not just the individuals who do some harm to you, but it could be black people on the whole who will pay a gargantuan price for harming you in any way, shape, or form. And in the system of white supremacy, you just being a white person coming there, as you said, hey, maybe he could hook us up with some resources. Maybe he could help us get our area together or give us some money, anything like that. Do you think that that is a major, maybe one of the fundamental reasons that you are treated so well when you go to these black areas?
I probably should have made this a bit clear at the beginning and not generalized so much, but I think in certain areas, very much so, yes. But obviously, I've just sort of lumped all these black areas together, which I shouldn't have done. And, you know, obviously, each different township has a very different atmosphere. And there are certain places you go into where you do kind of feel that, yeah, I suppose, as you kind of quite succinctly put it, essentially, you're sort of being put on a pedestal because people, number one, yeah, they sort of maybe want to kind of feel like they're worth something because there's a white person in their hood, and number two, they think, oh my god, if something was to happen, this would reflect so badly on all of us. But you know, I do think in other situations it isn't so sort of uncomfortable, and people are just more relaxed, and they're just kind of vaguely interested by the fact you're there, and it is in those instances maybe just more about the general sort of Ubuntu, where anyone that comes in you sort of welcome, but without sort of getting down on your knees and kind of saying, oh, a white man. But there are many situations, not only in South Africa, but across Africa, where I've been made to feel, or where the situation has made me feel incredibly uncomfortable, because you have sort of received this very obviously special treatment purely by the virtue of being white in a black space. I mean, I've been in situations in Kenya where you're trying to get onto a minibus taxi, and the minibus taxi driver is trying to kick an old black woman out of the passenger seat so that the white guy can sit in the front. So this isn't something you just sort of see in South Africa, but you see it manifested in different ways all over Africa from my experience. So I'm always very conscious of sort of being in a situation where I feel like my race is in some way sort of dictating this kind of preferential treatment that I'm getting. And it can be very hard to try and sort of get around that without also insulting somebody, because maybe somebody sees, you know, they're trying to welcome you in their home and they sort of treating you as a guest of honor, and you're so sort of conscious of automatically being placed on this kind of white privileged pedestal that you're trying to sort of say, oh, no, thank you. And in doing so, insulting them. But I think the important thing is just sort of putting yourself in these situations and trying to navigate them. And sometimes it's not going to work, and sometimes it's going to be awkward, and sometimes it's going to be uncomfortable. But also sometimes it's just going to be really nice, and you feel that everyone's benefited and everyone's sort of approached that situation on a sort of relatively equal level. And often it is, I think, as simple as just stepping into a different space to allow that to happen, and kind of being willing. I mean, one way I find... one thing I find that is quite useful in terms of sort of, I suppose, in some way, like disempowering myself to make the situation more balanced, is to try to speak Xhosa, which is the language that many of the black people speak in the townships in Cape Town, at least, because I speak it so badly. So I instantly kind of make a fool of myself, and it sort of, you know, and sort of show a vulnerability in that space, that if I was to sort of persevere in English, I wouldn't kind of open myself up in that way, if that makes any sense.
That, at least to me, that does not represent any lessening of your power, and for me, very important distinction, not privilege, your power as a white man in the system of white supremacy, you fumbling through COSA or any other Negro dialect worldwide, but that's my assessment. I could be in error. I've been saying it a few times, you are not born in South Africa, because I do think that's important since we're talking about all this, just making sure I'm reminding listeners and even myself at times that you were not born there. You grew up in Devon in the UK, is that correct?
Yeah, that's right, yeah.
What can you kind of give us a sense of the demographics, what that area was like, how many non-white people you came in contact with in that area?
it's like lily white. I think I probably, you know, knew or came into contact with, like, I could probably count the number of people of color that I came into contact with before I was 18 on my hands. Whether at school, sort of socially in town. So it's a very, very white area of the country, quite sort of middle class, quite conservative. Yeah, so it was definitely not in any way kind of diverse or racially integrated.
How large, what size city in terms of population are we talking about in Devon?
So Devon is kind of like the province or the state, if you like. And Exeter is sort of the main city, I suppose. And that's nowadays, I think it's probably about 300,000 people. But it's grown a fair amount in the last 10 years or so since I left England, 14, 15 years or whatever. But at the time, I mean, even with now it is becoming quite a diverse city. But when I was there, you know, if you saw somebody that looked in any way kind of foreign on the street, it would be quite a surprise. You'd kind of be like, oh, wow, look, there's somebody that's not white and English. Yeah.
May we ask how old you are?
I'm 32.
32, okay. Pretty young guy, relatively. And in the piece that you wrote about, I'm a racist, but I'm trying my best to amend for that. And even some of the other pieces where you talk about your family members saying that even some of them might qualify as racist. What were some of the things that you heard in terms of white people talking about racism, white supremacy growing up, or talking about black people, talking about non-white people?
I mean, I think to a large degree, you know, a lot of these conversations are only things that I've kind of had with my family or people I grew up with kind of since I moved away, because growing up, it just, you know, it wasn't something that was really sort of part of my family's world, I guess. Like, we, you know, my parents, I think even more than me, had a very, like, white upbringing and had never really been exposed to anyone that wasn't, like, white, Christian and English most of the time. So I don't think, you know, we kind of had big kind of discussions about race either way, whether in a positive or a negative way. But I do remember sort of, you know, certain passing comments where, you know, I don't know, maybe my dad would read something in the paper and be like, oh, there's all these gangs in London, though they're all black, obviously. And I would sort of think, but why is he saying that's obvious? You know, I don't really understand. And I know that from an early, I don't know, I mean, let's guess and say maybe my early teens, there were certain things that I sort of began to question. But I really wasn't exposed to very much until I left home and moved to Oxford, where I started working in a bar, and was suddenly working with all kinds of different people. I don't know, you know, Muslims from kind of Pakistani or Bangladeshi background, but who'd grown up in Oxford, black South Africans, Indians, all different kinds of people. And then suddenly I was like, wow, okay, you know, now I want to ask questions. I guess I've always just been really inquisitive. But I think had I asked those questions of my parents, I don't know if they would have had particularly strong opinions either way. But I think, you know, at school, equally, I think that, you know, yeah, I think we were just never taught to question. I don't think, you know, we were necessarily kind of indoctrinated in a sort of racist way, but I think we were just never really encouraged to question things. So take something like the British Empire, which is something that since kind of coming and living in South Africa and traveling in Africa, but I've become very interested in because it's sort of, you know, it's sort of part of my history, and just the sort of oppression and the racism of the British Empire. We never learned about the British Empire in school. Absolutely nothing. I knew nothing about it before I left school. And, you know, I think that is quite telling. And you still hear that sort of 40% of people in the UK think that the British Empire was a good thing. And I don't think that that, you know, not to say that people in Britain aren't racist. There are a lot of racist people in Britain. But I think that speaks more to their lack of knowledge about the British Empire than it does to their, like, inherent racism or something. So I think it was more... Yeah, I think there was just a lot of stuff I didn't know before I left.
Fascinating, fascinating. I guess at what point did you say, hey, I'm going to do my traveling journalism writing thing and hit the continent? At what point did that happen?
Well, I'd sort of traveled a lot as soon as I left school. And as I say, I think I came from a pretty, like, you know, a small town background. And it was the kind of place where you either, like, got out as soon as you could or you sort of stayed there forever and you're still working in Blockbuster Video, like, 20 years later. So I got out and I traveled. And, you know, I've always had quite an inquisitive nature. So I wanted to see and, you know, expand my horizons. And I sort of started looking. I'd always kind of kept a journal when I was traveling and just sort of jotted down my thoughts and experiences. And I started thinking, well, you know, I'm traveling, I'm seeing these amazing places, I'm having these amazing experiences, I'm meeting these amazing people. And it would be nice to share that with other people. So that was the one motive. And the other side was just thinking, well, how can I kind of, you know, sustain my traveling financially? And so both those things kind of combined quite nicely in travel journalism. And then I moved to South Africa sort of looking to explore that more. I'd always been quite interested in Africa. You know, I'd read sort of books, well, not always. So after leaving school and starting traveling, I sort of picked up various books and I started reading books about various things to do with Africa. And Cape Town just sort of seemed like quite a good gateway into the rest of the continent, because obviously if you look at the map, it's right at the south, so you've got the whole continent to your north. And so I moved to Cape Town and I started just sort of looking into it and trying to find stories and speaking to people and trying to see what I could do with it. And it took a few years to really be able to make a lot of money, so I was still working in bars. But again, that was a great experience because I was working with all different kinds of South Africans that you, unfortunately, in Cape Town, you know, that's a situation that you still wouldn't be able to have that often. So I've been sort of full-time freelancing and making enough money to actually live and eat more than, like, bread and soup for about 3 years, I suppose.
And you've been on the continent in total how many years now?
About 6 years.
6 years, okay. Fascinating. So you were in South Africa when Madiba passed away at the end of 2013?
I was, yeah.
Fascinating. Wow, yeah, I guess you were there when President Obama visited as well.
I can't remember. When did he visit? I saw Michelle Obama when she was here.
I think he was there about 6 months before Madiba passed. It was like the summer of 2013.
Okay. Yeah, well, I would have been here. Yeah, definitely.
There were protests. I remember that. This is before the whole Roads Must Fall thing. They had people who were upset about some of the things he had done or not done. I remember that specifically. I think he went to one of the major universities and students were outside. They were picketing and angry and all that. I remember seeing some of that quite vividly. We had a different guest from South Africa on and we talked about some of that as well. Okay. Kind of moving to you write, folks can click the link. It's We have the article in the description of the program if folks want to check out what the report that we're talking about. I'm a racist, but I'm trying my best to amend for that. As you said, you being on the continent and starting to focus more of your writing on race and what you've learned being on the continent as a white man, being around lots and lots of dark people now. You write this report, again, in response to this white man, Matthew Tennyson, making his racist comments earlier this year about the athletic events there. You write, but Tennyson and so many others like him have doggedly refused to be as honest with themselves or anyone else as Piet, this is a different white man, was over tea that day in his lounge, instead repeatedly affirming that despite their racist language, they are not, in fact, racist, and they have black friends. I think part of the problem is that many of us white folks, myself included, tend to have this idea that racists like rapists are some kind of subhuman cave-dwelling monster rather than the enlightened, educated, caring, nice, and normal people that we think we are. Significant, I think this is one of the passages that kind of caught the listener who wanted you to come on the program, kind of caught his attention. Just based on this paragraph, would it be accurate to say, because I know you talk about some of the things that you used to do in this article, would it be accurate to say that you, as a white man, current right now, June 13, 2016, are a racist white supremacist? Would that be accurate?
Jeez, that's a really hard question. You know, I mean, I think the automatic response is always to say no, and I do genuinely try to believe that I'm not a racist, but do I still have certain racist stereotypes and ideas that could be undone? I mean, I would say almost definitely yes. But I think, you know, that, or I hope that I'm always kind of willing and always trying to do anything I can, as I kind of say in that article, to confront that and to unravel it, because I know that, as we kind of talked about earlier with the white fear of black people and stuff, that it is largely illogical. So do I consider myself a racist currently? No. Do I still benefit from a racist system? Yes, absolutely. Do I still possibly harbor certain racist sentiments that I am probably not even aware of? Yeah, I think I probably do. But I think that, you know, or I hope that a lot of the racist sentiments or views that I have by this stage overcome. But I think there's always things that come up that you sort of maybe don't realize are going to. So I don't want to categorically say that I'm absolutely not in any way a racist. I don't know if that's possible.
Now, this is why I think it's so critical in terms of having a global understanding of racism and having discussions, talking with people, white and non-white, worldwide, about this problem. At least for me, this has been so, so helpful in getting clarity about what it means to be white worldwide, because you see just so many of the exact same things, and when I'm talking specifically, some of the exact same responses from white people in discussions on racism. It is predictable. It's painfully predictable. When talking with white people, you will get infinite amounts of, yes, I have white privilege, and just gargantuan lists, encyclopedias of the amount of white privilege that they have and what they're able to do easier and things that they get and bad things that don't happen to them because they are white. You cannot find white people, generally speaking, who are willing to say, well, I have white power and these are ways that I practice racism. These are things that I do that uphold the system of racism, white supremacy. That does not happen. Even not getting white people who identify as racist. They might even say that I have racist stereotypes or racist ideas unknowingly. That's also a big trend as well, where white people somehow are just very, very ignorant about all of this, very unaware about all of this. Nobody is ever consciously, deliberately aware, yes, I'm white, I am a white supremacist, and these are things that I am doing to make sure that that system remains in place, South Africa, the continent, worldwide, forever. That just does not happen. And I think, in my opinion, that is a massive part of the problem. In fact, we had a white female author on the program in 2011. She said that that is one of the main reasons that we have not made more progress in solving this problem, thinking that there are some white people who are not racist, and that we need to recalibrate even the way that we think about racism, and not thinking that when it's someone says racist, thinking that it's a Klan member or someone maybe stomping around in Africa, South Africa, calling black people kafirs and that sort of thing. Just regular old white person doing things, saying things. They don't have to blatantly call black people names and what have you, but they certainly can do things in all areas of people activity to help maintain that structure. With that analysis, if I've said anything that's incorrect or does not make sense, is illogical, certainly correct me. Can you tell us, can you share with us any of the ways that you have practiced racism, even reflecting on your life, where you can look back and say, that is one thing that I did where I, as a white man, was practicing racism?
Yeah, I mean, definitely. Firstly, I don't really disagree with anything you said. It doesn't surprise me that everyone kind of gives you the same response. I can think of one example that sort of instantly springs up, was when I was first moved to South Africa. I was robbed at gunpoint, in Cape Town, sort of downtown, and it was a black guy, young guy, unfortunately fitted that sort of stereotype that every person that's afraid of black people has, hoodie, kind of, like, I don't know, just sort of in the dark, kind of, it had all the sort of stereotypes that I think people fear most. Anyway, the guy took my money, whatever, I was unharmed, but I know that for some time afterwards, I would find myself being very, very scared if I was suddenly in an area where everyone was black and I was the only white person, particularly with black men. And I found myself thinking, would I feel this way if a white guy had robbed me? Would I just go around white areas feeling that, it was threatening and dangerous because there was only white people there, even if it had been a white guy that robbed me? And I realized that I wouldn't. And that meant that was exceptionally racist. I was judging black areas to be threatening because a black guy had robbed me, and I'd sort of conflated that into something that made me have a certain fear towards all black people in the sort of aftermath of that, or all black men, at least. That was an exceptionally racist thing to think. And it was shocking. I think even by that stage, I'd sort of liked to think that I wasn't racist, but I couldn't deny that that was the way I felt in that situation. I couldn't help that. And I think, again, as you say, that is part of the problem and part of the path that needs to be taken to improve things. And part of what I wrote about in the article is that, we have to realize that we have to accept when we're being racist, or that we are inherently racist, rather than kind of constantly trying to deny it. And I think it is, I do think it is difficult because I think, as I say, we've been sort of taught that this is something that we want to distance ourselves from as much as possible, that we almost won't let ourselves believe it. And that's why I kind of hinged my article on this one guy who, was doing this outreach project. And when I asked him why he did all this work with young black kids, he said, well, I'm a racist, but I'm doing my best to amend for that. And that was something that just really stuck with me, because I don't think I'd ever heard anyone be so honest. or any white person be so honest about racism, about the way they felt towards black people. And so I think that, that's something that I try to kind of remember to a degree. And something, when I think back to situations where I have sort of reflexively felt things that were racist. That those are things that I have to try really hard to amend for and try really hard to challenge. And I think, you know, that possibly is part of the motivation for me kind of making a conscious effort to go and spend time in so-called black areas where people tell me not to go because it's crazy and dangerous and blah, 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 blah. Just, you know, as one example of that.
I know for listeners, if folks have questions, feel free to chime in. I know for myself, number one, the white male that you were talking about, Pete, that you referenced, where he said, I'm racist and I'm trying to make amends for that. He had this hiking program where he would take black children out and go hiking and what have you. I'm not sure how I would feel as a black parent about having an admitted white racist with my child, but that's just one to ponder on. The example that you cited in terms of ways that you have practiced racism, at least in my view, that is even something that I would encourage listeners to think about. It's been my experience that one of the ways white people practice white supremacy racism is to consistently portray themselves as being victims, frequently victims of some sort of black hooliganism, black criminality, black mistreatment, where your anecdote about practicing racism starts with a black person robbing you, where you are the victim of black crime, and then you subsequently having racist thoughts about black people, generalizing that black people are criminals and that I'm afraid of black people, where a lot of people, even I suspect a lot of non-white people, black people hearing that would say, hey, that's not racist, that's totally logical. I would be frightened of black people if I had been robbed. And they might even say, hey, if a white person had done that, I would be too, but you weren't robbed by a white person, you were robbed by a black person. And I hearken back to what you said earlier about in terms of crime, in terms of lower class, quote-unquote, people generally committing crimes, they have fewer resources, and that is tied with race. In my opinion, even the way that we conceptualize crime, what gets labeled a crime, that is a major aspect of white supremacy. In my view, there is no greater crime on the planet than racism, white supremacy. Racists would be the biggest criminals on the planet. They do not just take your wallet. They take your entire continent and call it theirs and change the names and might even take you and enslave you or whatever the case is going to be. There's no greater crime on the planet in comparison to that, to taking a few nickels or quarters or whatever the case may be, rand, depending on where you are in that part of the world. So for me, that is a pretty, it is a very weak illustration of ways that you practice racism, white supremacy, and even embedded in that is the white victimization. And I can see a lot of people even saying that that doesn't sound racist to me. That just sounds like a typical human response to being violated or robbed. And in my view, it should not be very difficult. If we can be honest, just being honest, and you say the part of this in your article is white people not being defensive and not taking it personal, just you as a white man being conscious of that, it should not be difficult for a white person to think of ways that they have practiced racism, particularly you're 32 years old, so you have decades of this. Are there other ways that you can think of, being honest, where you have practiced racism at any point in time in your life?
I think there are various occasions. I know you sent me a question before this about roads must fall. I think that is another situation where I had very, I had very limited sympathy to begin with to that movement, and had a sort of feeling that it was, you know, people just sort of trying to erase a chapter of history that whether good or bad, it happened and you shouldn't try to erase history. And then I decided that, you know, it was something that I wanted to find out more about. And as I spoke to other people, you know, I realized that it was, there was a very different story to it. And that, you know, somebody kind of pointed out to me, well, you're talking about people wanting to erase history, but you white people have erased African history for hundreds of years. And yet you assume that, you know, because we want to take down one statue, that that's something like terribly wrong against the sort of sacrosanct history of the world. I think there are the regular kind of more daily things. I mean, I think I drew on the crime situation because I think it was the time when I was sort of most aware of it being such a kind of physical feeling towards people that were in some way different to me, people of color, in terms of the fear element, because I think that is in South Africa, that is a big part of the racism, is, you know, sort of bound up in fear. But if you're talking about more of the sort of everyday kind of structural level of racism, then yeah, I mean, I think, you know, there are various other things. I think that, you know, there have been times in the past where maybe I've been sort of perhaps more surprised if somebody that was of color, you know, was particularly well-spoken or particularly articulate than if it were a white person. Or I don't know, what other kind of everyday examples could I give you? A sort of sense that, like, when I was in Oxford and, you know, I had a friend, Bangladeshi Muslim descent, and his sister had an arranged marriage, and just sort of having very, very limited views about what that meant, and it being this sort of horrible, oppressive thing. So I think that, as I say, there are many situations where I have had very racist views about things. And without constantly trying to seem defensive, I think that, you know, I just hope that I'm always trying to challenge those when I can, and to be willing to listen to people who challenge my views, and particularly people of color. And so, you know, I really appreciate that. I really appreciate you having me on the show, number one, and I'm, you know, very interested by what you've had to say and your opinions, and I definitely will take everything you've said on board. And I thank you for being so candid and honest with me and kind of poking holes in what I've said. I think it's, you know, it's important, and it's sometimes really hard to take. But I think it's, for me, the biggest step is listening. Listening to people who tell you you're wrong, listening to people who tell you you're racist, listening to people who tell you the way you see the world is one-sided. This is hugely important for me. So I feel that it's, you know, as you said, 32, I'm still a relative young man. I think it's something I'm constantly learning. But equally, I think, sorry, just to finish, I say that people need to be less defensive, but I think that is also part of the learning curve, and that's something I'm still learning as well, you know. And it is, I think it's a pretty human reaction to be defensive. And I think it's, yeah, you know, I appreciate you for calling me out for that as well.
For sure. You wrote about, it's on your website. Folks can check out some of the different posts where you write about race. But you said, I have had a grueling 1.5-year education from my fast-tongued and politically fiery black South African girlfriend to boot. You actually have a couple posts where you talk about, I guess, what people would call interracial dating, interracial relationships in South Africa, how you don't see too much of this in South Africa, and that sometimes if you do see it, people are, oh my gosh, look at that, it's a white guy with a black female, or vice versa, what have you, however it's manifested. And you've almost got to the point where you're like, man, if you're going to, you know, stare and gawk at that level, you know, give us 20 rand and you can take a picture, what have you. In terms of you as a white man, and you even write about how there is a lot of racist fetishizing of black bodies, male and female, where that seems to be one of the things where the white tourist can come to Africa, any part of it, and, oh yes, I can have some sort of sexual liaison with a black person, and that will, you know, get to my roots, or that will help me cleanse from my racism, or I've had an authentic African experience. And you said that, you know, what you and your partner have experienced is not that at all, that you had previously pretty much only dated white females, and that it had nothing to do with her being a black female, just you all hit it off and, you know, ended up having a quality relationship. Is that an accurate summation?
Yeah, I mean, that's quite an old post, the one you quoted. So it's, we've been together for about 4 years now, coming up to 4 years. And I think that, you know, I think that it is, and I'm sure I've said this in my post, I think that, it's something that we kind of confront together. as a couple fairly regularly is this sort of that we are, I think, in South Africa in a pretty small number of people where it's what you might call a sort of genuine relationship where there isn't sort of a whole lot of other stuff that kind of plays into it, whether that is, yeah, some kind of fetish on the one side or the other, or possibly, you know, an aspect where it's about money or it's about, you know, this idea. And it works both ways. I mean, I think, and I'm sure I said this in one of the articles at least as well, is that often, you know, there's an assumption, say, from the black point of view, that like, oh, if I'm with a white guy, he'll treat me better, because the racism also obviously plays into the black community. And there's an assumption even in many black areas and black communities that white men are better than black men. So, you know, I would like to think that we are, no, I mean, I'm sure that we have a good relationship. And I, as I said in one of the articles, again, you know, that our race doesn't kind of in any way define our relationship, but it also does make it interesting on a certain level, because we have different outlooks on the world that are to some degree formed by our different races, and also our experiences of the world have been in some way influenced by our different races, and that's something where we can always learn from each other as well. So I think it's something interesting, but it's not something that in any way defines our relationship.
I certainly would take the position that racism, white supremacy, that is the definitive power dynamic on the planet. It is always going to be the definitive aspect of white people and non-white people interacting, relating, whether it's in some sort of sexual arrangement or not, just because we are in a global system of white supremacy. We talk here a lot about, number one, having an accurate understanding of racism, white supremacy, and then things that victims of white supremacy can and should do to end the system, replace it with a system of justice, things that we can do or things that we should do, things that we shouldn't do. One of the things that we suggest all the time is non-white people not being engaged in any sort of sexual arrangement with a white person, because in a system of racism, white supremacy, that is incorrect behavior. The white person is always, whether it is a white man or a white woman, that white person is always taking advantage of that non-white person in that power dynamic. That is a colossal, a monumental act of white supremacy, that white person being sexually involved with a white person. If I was going to give a comparison, it would be the same thing as a Nazi during the Third Reich being sexually involved with a quote-unquote Jew. It would be the same power dynamic as a warden or a jailer being sexually involved with a prisoner. That white supremacy is a massively unequal power dynamic, that every single white person, you, Mr. Clark included, has way more power than non-white people. And frequently non-white people are very confused about racism, that you're really exploiting someone who is very, very confused, in addition to being in a much less powerful position, but very confused about what is happening with regards to racism, white people in general. Is that logical, what I've just said, in terms of why these tragic arrangements, white people being sexually involved with white people, is it logical? Does it make sense? Not do you agree with it per se, but just is it logical in terms of why I'm saying that these arrangements are incorrect and that they are inherently exploited every time?
I don't agree, to be honest. I think that, you know, I think that there is...
I didn't ask if you agreed. I was very clear about that. I said, is it logical? If you want to give us why you disagree or agree, that's fine too. But is it logical?
Is it logical? I mean... I can understand the logic, yes, if that's what you're asking. I mean, I can understand that it could be perceived that way. But I think, you know, I suppose you kind of lost me a bit when you started talking about the Nazis, like sort of, you know, just to sort of take how I feel about my relationship and my partner and how, you know, I think she feels about me and our relationship. And to in any way kind of draw a comparison with the Nazis is obviously a bit of a hard one to take on a personal level.
Why? I mean, not putting it on you personally. This is not even anything personal about you. This is just in general with the system of racism, white supremacy. What happened with Adolf Hitler, Nazi Germany? Would that not be a quintessential example of white supremacy in action?
No, of course it would. Okay. Absolutely.
That's just what I'm citing. Illustrations of racism, white supremacy, and how that power dynamic operates. We agreed at the beginning of the program we are still globally in a system of white supremacy, South Africa, worldwide, yes?
Yeah, no, I'm absolutely not disagreeing with that. No.
Okay. And it would be logical if someone, Nazi Germany, if a Jewish person said, hey, we have monumental injustice going on here. I am not going to be sexually engaged with a Nazi under these conditions until this problem has been completely resolved to my satisfaction. That would make logical sense, yes?
Yes, okay. But, you know, Nazis were people who, to whether or not, or you know, whatever level they may or may not have been aware of what they were doing, were consciously inflicting, you know, incredible violence upon Jewish people. I just think it's a bit of an extreme example in if you're talking about kind of interracial relationships in a present day situation.
Do you think it would be accurate to say that white people worldwide as a collective are inflicting monumental violence directly and indirectly on non-white people worldwide presently, 2016? Is that accurate?
Yeah, but okay. I think that, you know, you're talking about Nazis versus, like, we're not talking about Germans, for example. You know, you're talking about Nazis, a specific type of white person, for example, in that scenario. We're not talking, or a specific type of German. Not every German was a Nazi. You know, and I think maybe the same case applies. I don't think that, you know, you can personally, I don't feel that you can say that every single white person is inflicting monumental violence on black people in the same, to the same degree, at least in the same way. I mean, maybe, you know, are we talking about white people still being part of a white supremacist system? Absolutely. I'm not disagreeing with that, but I just think it's always a bit, I don't know, drawing comparisons with Hitler and the Nazis in this particular instance. I just think that maybe is problematic.
I could pick out lots of different illustrations. I could use the analogy of slavery, whether it's the plantation master and the slave. I already gave the illustration of the warden. I even use the workplace, for example, because they do have rules and regulations. I know at least they do in the States. I don't know about South Africa, but I know they here. They have rules and regulations about employers not being in sexual relationships with their employees. They have this in academic institutions as well. I know Harvard just made rules about this as well, where professors are not supposed to be involved in any sexual relationships with students, male or female, because there is an unequal power dynamic, and they, many folks who put these rules in place, they feel it is inherently exploitative. Do they have any such rules, regulations like that in South Africa, either in employment situations or academic settings?
Yeah, I mean, I think obviously in schools and stuff, you know, it's the same thing. In universities, I think it's generally a sort of unwritten rule. I don't think it's a kind of official policy, but I think that, you know, there's a general feeling that, for example, university professors should not have sexual relations or whatever with students. Teachers and pupils, definitely. But I think that, you know, I still think that it's, you're talking about a significantly broader kind of disparity in the power relation there. And I'm not talking about, like, all interracial relationships, but I'm just talking specifically about mine in this instance. You know, I don't think that comparing, say, a university lecturer or a teacher and a student and me and my partner is in any way a good comparison.
Why?
Because I don't think there is that kind of that greater difference in the power dynamic in our instances. I think that, and I think to consider it in any way exploitative is also kind of hugely undermines the agency of my partner in the situation, and to, it sort of assumes that she is in some way, you know, the victim in the situation. And I think she would also take that as a great insult.
I've heard that before. Many people who are, unfortunately, in these arrangements. Is it accurate to say that your partner, this black female, that she is a victim of white supremacy? Would that be an accurate statement?
No, of course she is.
Okay. And you are a white man, as we have already pointed out. Just even that right there, I would like folks to reflect on that. Anywhere on the planet in 2016, a white man and a black female, and if people think that there is a power differential between those two, anywhere in the world, Greenland, South Africa, Indonesia, Vietnam, Georgia, the state I was talking about, anywhere in the world, if people think they are on equal footing, white man, black female, anywhere in the world, you can think about that and come to your own conclusions. In my view, have you experienced where black people have been confused about racism, white supremacy frequently, where black people did not have an accurate understanding of how this was working, where they thought this is how racism operates, and then later on down the road they found out that that was wrong, it was something else? Has that been your experience?
Yeah, of course, but I really don't think that, I mean, you know, my partner, her work involves, like, she's a theatre producer who writes theatre that deals with race politics, that deals with white supremacy being inflicted on black people. I mean, this is stuff that she understands. And it isn't, I just don't think, you know, you keep coming back to this overall feeling, and I'm in no way denying that, like, anyone black, you know, that black and white people are not on an equal footing. But does that mean that a black and white relationship, whether that's a friendship, a sexual relationship, whatever else, is inherently kind of exploitative on the part of the white person? No, I don't think so.
Do you think it's logical for every non-white person to be suspicious that any individual white person, yourself included, could be a white supremacist as long as the system exists? Do you think it's logical that non-white people have that sort of suspicion?
Yeah, I mean, I'm in absolutely no way questioning the suspicion. And I think that, again, referring to my own relationship, you know, that there was definitely a suspicion that was there at the outset of our relationship on the part of my partner, who was very dubious about, you know, my race and what that meant, and what that meant in terms of the power dynamic between us. And what that meant about me as an individual in relation to her as well. So, you know, that's something that has, to a degree, been considered and been dealt with, you know.
In my opinion, for me, things would be dealt with, quote-unquote, when the system no longer exists. In my opinion, that would be phenomenal motivation for whites like yourself. If you are really interested in having an authentic, healthy relationship, sexual relationship with a black person, get busy solving the problem of racism. Then we can be sure that nobody has been fooled, nobody has been duped, nobody is being exploited in all of this, because the system of white supremacy doesn't exist. Then all of my questions, all of my suspicions are null and void, because this problem doesn't exist anymore. That's, I think, the best approach, particularly 2016, because we've been dealing with this problem for a long time, and white people have been white people have been raping and sexually exploiting black people for a long time. Many of our white guests on this program, I have asked them point blank, is white rape of black people, is that a fundamental aspect of white culture? And to my surprise, quite a few of our white guests have said no hemming and hawing, no beating around the bush immediately. Yes. In fact, I'll ask you before I get to some of our callers, do you think white rape of black people, is that a fundamental aspect of white global culture?
Yeah, I mean, but I think that equally, you know, it's an aspect of any sort of system of power. You know, you can look at it in various different contexts, but absolutely, I think, it is. It is part of white global power and domination, and has been throughout history, and it's something I've actually been writing about recently with regards to Namibia, where there was, I don't know if you know the story or not, but there was a terrible genocide of two of the particular ethnic groups in Namibia, and sort of systematic rape was, you know, inherent in that period of history and in that system in Namibia, and it has been across Africa and across a lot of the world in terms of white imperial history.
I'm just making sure, is this the period you're talking about, like early 20th century? I think whites from so-called Germany who came in were doing some of this stuff, or am I flawed in my thinking?
No, yeah, you're right. 1904 to 1908.
Okay. Yeah, that grizzly. In fact, we were talking about Nazi Germany. I think they were practicing some of the techniques that later got employed during the Third Reich. Am I accurate?
Yes, you are. Yeah, they I don't know if practicing is the right word, but they you could say they possibly formulated some of the things that were later used, were sort of stemmed from things that were used in Namibia. In terms of the racial science as well, you know, that was when the victims were killed or died in the concentration camps, their bodies were, well, their skulls were, their heads were, they were decapitated, their heads were boiled, and the skulls were sent back to Germany to be used to kind of supposedly prove theories about African inferior intelligence.
Wow. We have heard some of that before, medical apartheid. And in fact, even I think in South Africa right now, there's a big to-do about the 20-year anniversary of the Truth and Reconciliation Commission and wrapping up formal apartheid. That came up frequently there as well, that rape and sexual abuse was a frequent tool in suppressing black people that were rebelling against apartheid. And I remember, I think they were using pliers on people's genitalia and sodomizing. I mean, just horrors. You know, if you have the stomach to go back and read, this is a long-running pattern. I wanted to nab some of the folks who dialed in with questions. Folks have questions you'd like to ask Mr. Clark. The number is 641-715-3640, and the code is 564-943-POUND. The caller at 94, last four digits, 9401, 9401. Did you have a question for Mr. Clark? You should be with us.
Hello. Can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Ah, great. I have a question. My question is, he said that he's not racist right now. And I want to know what makes him think he's not racist right now. Mr. Clark?
Yes, I'm here. Hi. I said I would like to think that. I mean, I can't necessarily prove it, obviously, but I think that, you know, I think that I have come to a point where I would be exceptionally surprised if I was ever in a situation where I found myself making some kind of value judgments about a person that was in front of me based on anything to do with their race, and for that matter, their sexual orientation and anything else. And, you know, I think that, as I said, there may well be situations that arise, but I would like to think that I am... Yeah, I don't know. Like I said, it's difficult to prove, but I don't think I'm racist, no.
Oh, so you're not sure if you're racist or not, that's what you're saying?
I can't say 100% for sure, because I don't know. You know, there might be a situation where I'm faced with something that shows me that I still harbor some kind of racist feelings about something. So I don't want to say like 100% no. But I think I would like to think that I'm not.
So if you're not sure if you're racist or not, how are you sure that you won't practice racism against your non-white partner?
Because in 4 years, I don't think I ever have so far. And because I have never felt that, and I think I'm very honest with myself in this, and I spend a lot of time thinking about and analyzing my relationship, and I don't think I have ever, you know, in any way felt that anything to do with her race informs how I feel about her, or, you know, whether good or bad or anything else, or any of the observations that I've made about her personality or anything else.
You're also talking early. I heard you say this more than one time. You kept on talking about monsters, races being monsters. Do you think there is such a thing as a good racist?
Is there such a thing as a good racist? I don't think there's a good racist, but I think that there are people who would, you know, by sort of general, the people's general feeling about what it means to be a good person, I think there are plenty of people who would be considered good people by most of the people around them who are racist. And people who, you know, do a lot of good deeds and generally live pretty good lives who are racist, yeah.
Okay. Have you ever mistreated anybody because they were not white?
Have I ever
not
mistreated?
Just thinking about somebody, yeah, mistreat somebody, like, yeah, abuse them because they were not white.
I've never abused somebody because they were not white, no. Have I had negative stereotypes about somebody because they were not white? Yes. I said as much. So, I mean, in a way, I suppose you could consider that a form of abuse. But have I directly abused someone because they were not white? No, definitely not.
How does a white person stop themselves from being a racist?
I think just like within South Africa, I think at least a big part of it is just to stop being so defensive. And I know that I've admitted that I also need to do that sometimes, and I still am prone to get defensive. But I think that, you know, at least realizing that and realizing that that's something I need to improve is part of that process. But I think that we in South Africa, and I don't know how much this applies in the States, but I would imagine it's probably similar. As soon as you're labeled a racist, as soon as anything you do or say is in any way connected with racism, you instantly get your guard up. And just sort of shut down the conversation because you can't face it. I think at the very least, you know, people have to start being willing to listen. And even if they are not yet necessarily ready to be like, okay, well, maybe you're right, maybe I am a racist, at least be willing to listen to people. And I think that is the biggest problem in South Africa is that people don't listen. People instantly shoot down arguments and kind of, you know, use their white privilege to sort of say, oh, this is hurting me and I don't want to hear it, so you have to stop.
But I mean, for like white supremacy to end, like white people have to actually do something to stop practicing racism, correct? It's not just about listening, correct?
Absolutely. But I think that, you know, that is, how do you know what to do unless you are willing to listen first to what people think needs to be done? You know, you have to listen, you have to read, you have to understand before you can do anything. I mean, it's like trying to start a business if you know nothing about business. Like, your business is going to fail. You have to learn about it first. You have to read about it. You have to listen to it. You have to understand it. And I think that there is a huge gulf in understanding. And that in itself is an active move. You know, it's not just a passive thing. You have to actively seek out information and seek out knowledge about how you can confront racism or how you can confront racists or being racist and anything connected to that.
It seems to me that you're saying that white people are ignorant of racism. So I will stop right here. Thank you, Gus, for letting me ask my questions, and I'll let other callers go. Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. I got that impression, too. The caller in Michigan, did you have questions for Mr. Christopher Clark? You should be with us.
May I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Good evening, Gus. And just a couple questions to the guest. The last caller asked a couple of my questions. I want to thank her for her questions. But you did say that it's logical for black people to be suspicious of all white people. Is that correct to the guest?
Yeah.
Okay, so if there is no, like, master list of who's a racist and who's not a racist, how do victims, I'm a victim, determine who's a racist and who is not?
Well, I suppose that... Jeez, that's a good question. That's a difficult question. I suppose that probably comes down to the part of, say, the white person in question or the white people in question to try and convince you that they are not. You know, I think the suspicion is natural. And I think that in that instance that, yeah, you know, I think it come, that is maybe part of what we have to, we as in us white people, myself and all the white people have to do, is to sort of try and actively gain the trust of people. But I think equally that can be dangerous because you don't want to kind of overcompensate and be trying to make a big point of sort of saying, look at me and I treat everyone fairly and look how nice I am to you as a black person or whatever, because then it also becomes a kind of a self-affirming exercise. So I think it's an incredibly difficult question. But I think that, again, you know, it's part of these are the kinds of conversations that need to be had. And I think one of the issues in South Africa is that there are still not enough spaces where somebody like me, a white person, is being put on the spot and being asked these kinds of questions and being willing to consider them and think about them. So, yeah, I think you've kind of stumped me, to be honest. I don't really know.
My next question is, who do you think is most confused about racism, white people or non-white people, and why?
Sorry, I didn't hear. You were in a bit quiet there.
Who do you think is most confused about racism, white supremacy, white people or non-white people, and why?
Well, white people, because I think they, you know, it's much easier to understand something when it's being inflicted upon you, whereas for white people, obviously, they are the inflictors, and I think that they, you know, the sort of the challenge to white supremacy and the sort of vocalness around that and the kind of momentum that is gaining now, at least in South Africa, that's quite a modern phenomenon for white people to have to deal with. And I think many white people still don't get it and still think, you know, what? I'm part of a racist, but we, you know, it's all equal. We all had the same opportunities. I went to a good school. My parents worked hard and they put me, you know, there's still a lot of misunderstanding from white people. And I think sometimes it's, you know, again, it comes back to the defensiveness because you almost don't want to look into it because it sort of challenges the core of everything about your life. It's like, it's like asking a Christian to sort of question their beliefs in God. It can potentially shake the whole foundation of your world. So I think that definitely, you know, black people are much clearer about what it means than white people.
Okay, my last question is, how does your work in particular, if it does at all, help to end racism?
Well, I think that, you know, and I'm not going to claim that I'm making like a, you know, world-changing contribution, but I think that I do try to play an active role, both as a journalist and outside of that work. And I think there are various ways. I mean, one way, in terms of my writing at least, I try to write about areas that, you know, well, let's say, I keep saying, kind of so-called black areas in Cape Town, in a very different light, and kind of looking at those areas beyond the crime and the rape and all the stuff that normally gets covered in the papers, and kind of paint a fuller picture. I write about young black social entrepreneurs, for example, who come from those areas and are doing great work in those areas. Or I try to encourage people to, you know, try to encourage other white people, for example, to step out of their comfort zones and to make themselves, put themselves into areas where they might feel uncomfortable, and to see that, you know, there's a lot that can be learned from that, and there's interesting engagements that can be had there and gaps that can be bridged. Also in South Africa, there's a big problem with xenophobia from black South Africans to other black Africans. And I teach English at a school for refugees, which are mostly Black African refugees, and I also try to use my position as an educator in that situation to talk about race and to talk about xenophobia and to talk about different forms of oppression, and to both give my own insight as somebody who lives in South Africa to people who haven't been here very long and maybe don't understand certain things, but also to listen to them and to try and learn and understand things together. So I think often what I'm getting at, it's about putting yourself in different spaces and encouraging other people to do the same. And I think, you know, another thing that is possibly harder to do, but that I try to do as much as possible, is kind of consciously calling out anything that you see or hear that is racist, whoever that comes from, you know, whether that is from a white South African, whether it's from a foreigner, whatever it is, whether it's from my family, whether it's from somebody I walk past on the street. If I see or hear something that I think is obviously racist, I will try to always challenge that and say that I think that sentiment is wrong and that I don't agree with it, and or whatever, you know, whatever is needed to be said in that situation. Does that answer your question?
That's sufficient. My last question, it just sparked up when you responded to this one. Are the Black people that you're around, you say you teach at a school and just, you know, you're comfortable, obviously, around the Black people in your area. Are they suspicious of you? Of being racist? Or are they comfortable around you?
I would like to think that the majority of them are comfortable around me. I'm sure that there are people that I deal with who harbor some kind of suspicion. But I would like to think that the people that I've spent considerable time with and have sort of got to know relatively well would not be suspicious of me, no.
Okay. So would you consider yourself a good white person?
Yeah, I mean, I think that generally I'm, you know, I would like to think that in general I'm a good person. And I think that if there are areas that I feel I could be better, or that I, you know, that I am not a good person, I'm always trying to improve in those areas. And I think for me, in terms of my personal growth, not only with regards to race, but in general, I think that that is the most important thing, is that, you know, it's never a sort of finished task. You're always... being a good person is a constant process, and it's something that I'm always trying to be. But do I come up short? Definitely, sometimes. But I think in general I am a pretty good person, and I think in terms of dealing with different kinds of people, different races, different religions, different whatever, that applies there as well.
Okay, thanks for taking my call, and thanks for having this guest on, Gus, to discuss the global system of racism and white supremacy. I appreciate this conversation. Thanks.
For sure.
If anyone is ignorant about racism, it's black people.
Worldwide. Caller at 5992. Did you have a question for Mr. Clark?
Yes, may I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, hello, everyone. Yes, I just have a few questions. How old were you when you realized that you didn't want to be racist anymore?
It's hard to say. I mean, I think that, you know... I think as I say, I didn't really realize probably that I was, you know, in any way racist until I left school and started being exposed to different people and different races. And I think as soon as I was in situations where I found I had sort of racist feelings in those situations, or that I was a racist in those situations, then that made me want to challenge it. So I think as soon as I left school and started traveling and being exposed to different people in different places, that's when it kind of started.
Okay. Are you an independent journalist, or do you work for an establishment?
No, I'm an independent journalist.
Okay. Even so, as an independent journalist, you still are high up there on the professional scale. So at any time, do you contribute to racism? Because in order for other people to want to publish your information, I would think you would have to be aligned with their ideology or their doctrines in South Africa. So is there any way you contribute to racism as a journalist?
Yeah, I mean, I suppose that obviously, as with all industries, you know, the media industry in South Africa, and as it is everywhere in the world, is still a predominantly white industry, and supports a sort of white supremacist system to a degree. In some ways I have sort of played into that racist system in the past, but that then now that I have a sort of greater footing in that system, I'm trying to maybe reverse that trend through sort of focusing more on the sort of other side, and trying to kind of look at stories from a different angle, that is possibly to a very small degree, kind of refashioning the house from the inside, if that makes any sense.
Okay, do you consider yourself an outcast as a journalist in South Africa, that you are on the side of anti-racism?
I think in some situations, I mean, I'm often invited on press trips, for example, where, you know, there are no black people, it's only white people, and I sometimes voice that is strange in a country where more than 70% of the population are black, and I've generally found that when that is voiced, most other people in the room haven't noticed, or think that it's weird that I've noticed, or feel uncomfortable that I've mentioned it. You know, that's one example. But I think that, you know, I think that if I was being completely honest, you know, it has been in a weird way something that has indirectly benefited me, because I am writing from a perspective that not many people are. So often people actually are more interested in my work and want me to be part of whatever their publication is or whatever, because I'm writing from a sort of outcast perspective. So it's a bit of a paradox in a way, I guess. But at the same time, that allows me to reach a wider audience with sort of alternative perspectives. So I suppose, again, it's, you know, yes, in some instances I do feel like a bit of an outcast, but that's also something that I can kind of use to my advantage, but also to the advantage of maybe my agenda, to kind of create a bit of a different outlook amongst white South Africans. I mean, that's still the majority of people that read my stuff, so I feel that I'm in a good position to influence them.
Okay, I just have one more question. The previous caller asked you who was more confused about racism, whether it was white people or black people. When you said white people are more confused, is that correct?
Yes, that's correct, yeah.
I have a difficult time understanding that, since racism as we know it actually takes ownership by white people. White people don't seem to have a problem with it. They don't really try to come up with any solutions. They practice it. They benefit from it. They created it. So I don't understand how they are confused.
I think that's a difficult question, but I think that it's because, you know, because black people are on the receiving end of it, they understand very well what it is. Whereas for many white people, their involvement in the system is kind of completely subconscious or largely subconscious, and they don't necessarily really know because, you know, I mean, if you take again the media industry, for example, you know, the majority of the media is supporting that white supremacist system. So white people consuming that media are not aware that they are part of that system. Black people, you're very aware because you're feeling it every day, I imagine. But for white people, you know, it's something that you don't have to understand because you've never had to be on the receiving end of it.
Right, but they're the ones who are provoking all of this type of behavior. It's no way that they cannot understand because they hear about it every day. They hear how black people are being killed, not only in South Africa, but other parts of Africa, other parts of the world. They have to realize because they benefit from it, and I don't think they want to give up their benefits, you know, to align themselves, you know, with us. So I'm still not quite sure how they do not understand. I mean, they walk around and not consciously think about it, but if it's inherent, like that's the word you use, is if it's inherent, there's no way they cannot see it or understand it on a daily basis in some aspect of their own life. So how are you confused about racism? And if anything, white people should be confused about how black people see it and deal with it, because we haven't treated white folks the way they've been treating us for centuries. That's what they may be confused about, but the idea of them being confused about, you know, their own creation and everything that's involved in racism, I just don't understand that.
I hear what you're saying, but I think that, like I say, I think that, yes, you're right. Obviously, people see this stuff on the news, but they see it according to the system that they've been brought up in. And so they, you know, to you, you see, okay, there's black people being shot, and this is obviously racism, and it's about that, and it's so clear to you. But I think that, you know, white people's view of these things, it's informed very differently. So if they hear about some guy being shot, you know, the first thing they think is like, how is this another black kid, say, in the States being shot by another white policeman? How is this happening? This racism is, you know, this is racism. It's terrible. Their first thing is like, well, maybe he was stealing something. Maybe he provoked the cop. Maybe he had a weapon on him. You know, so they're not coming at it from the same view that you are. So I can understand how it would be very hard to understand how they don't understand. But I think that it's, you know, the kind of frame that they're looking at it through is so different, and that we are looking at it through, all white people, is so different, you know. And the conversations that we have, the things people tell us about, we might read the same news even, but what people around us in the white community say, tell us about that news, or the opinions that they have about that news are completely different. And I think, again, a lot of it, you know, is possibly, as you were saying, a kind of unwillingness, and it, possibly an unconscious or subconscious unwillingness to understand, because, as I say, as I kind of said about a Christian being asked to, like, you know, question their belief in God, like, you know, it's so fundamental to everything about us that you instantly put your guard up and think, oh no, it's, you know, I don't want to understand this because it challenges everything about my whole life.
Caller, we'll leave it there. I just want to make sure I get in as many of the callers as I can before we run out of time. The person that dialed in, 4950, did you have a question for Mr. Clark? You should be with us.
Yes, can I be heard?
Yes, sir.
Yes, I have a question. I want to know, due to the fact that he understands the power dynamic between him and the female that he, quote-unquote, says that he's dating, will he end that relationship? If yes, why? And if no, why? Just explain your answer, please.
No, I mean, I'm not going to end my relationship because I, you know, I feel that I do not feel that my personal relationship with my partner is in any way exploitative. And yeah, it's as simple as that. I mean, I understand how the power dynamics could be seen to work, but I personally just, I don't feel that it's the way it's been portrayed or is an adequate reflection of our relationship. Yeah.
So you don't think that the system of racism affects your relationship?
I think it, you know, I think it affects both of us as people. I think it affects, you know, our relationship in a degree because it affects both of us as people and affects us differently as people and has affected the way we grew up as people. But I do not think that racism has, you know, an influence on our day-to-day relationship with each other when we're alone without the sort of, without the world kind of poking into our lives. No.
That's interesting. And also, I just wanted to let people know that they hear you chuckle at least twice. So just keep that noted. And thanks for taking my call.
Right on. Caller in the Bay Area, did you have a question for Mr. Clark? You should be with us, Bay Area caller. Did you have a question?
Yes, can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you. Hi, I'd like to say hi to the guest. And my question for you is, you say you don't consider yourself a racist just from listening to you speak?
Yes.
So what do you do to replace the system of racism, white supremacy, with a system of justice? And not sleeping with the black lady. I mean, just what do you do constructively?
Well, I think I kind of touched on this with the previous caller, and I think, you know, a couple of callers back, and I think on one level it's something I try to do through my work in terms of, number one, confronting racism in my writing, but also just sort of trying to give a different perspective about different areas and, you know, sort of say to paint a more well-rounded picture of black areas and kind of focus on black people that are doing positive things rather than the kind of usual negativity that you tend to see in the press. You know, so that was the one thing I mentioned. And I think, secondly, it is, you know, as I said also in that previous call, kind of calling out racism in person when you see it and when you hear it, and whoever mm-hmm. that comes from, being willing to mm-hmm. actually attack and call out somebody who harbors racist sentiments or says something racist or does something that is obviously racist.
You're speaking of white males or white females when you say if they're saying or doing something that you consider racist, that you say something to them, you mean Caucasians?
Yes. So, I mean, I can give you a small example. There was a time recently I was just at the shop opposite my house here. Mm-hmm. And I was walking out of the shop and there was a black guy getting into a car, a BMW. It was one of the newer models of the BMW. Black tinted windows, personalized number plates, big rims, like nice car, a lot of money obviously spent on that car. And as he was getting in the car, I walked past a white guy who said to his wife, oh, he obviously stole that car. So I stopped and I turned around, and part of the learning process for me in these situations is learning how to deal with the situation without just getting really angry and sort of letting the adrenaline go to your head, and because that obviously doesn't really help, because then people just think you're crazy or they get too defensive, and trying to sort of talk to somebody in a measured way. And I just, you know, I said to the guy, I'm sorry, but I just heard what you said, and I absolutely do not think it's okay to speak like that about other South Africans, and I live here and I really do not condone that kind of behavior around here. And, you know, this is 2016 and you need to like realize that the world is changing, and kind of get with the times. So that would be one example of trying to sort of deal with it on a day-to-day basis.
Oh, okay. So have you ever been suspected of being a suspected racist? Or have black people ever vocally stated that they were suspicious of your intent?
I didn't think, well, I mean, my partner has definitely, when we were first dating or reflecting on when we were first dating, has said that she was very suspicious of my intent. And I think I had to sort of do a certain amount of work to win her over in that regard. But I think in general, I've definitely been in situations where I felt that people were suspicious of my intent, but I can't think of other examples where people have actually vocalized it. But it was definitely something that came up regularly in the early stages of my relationship with my partner.
Your line, your sound kind of got really bad all of a sudden. I don't know if something switched, but it's hard to hear you now.
Can you hear me better right now?
Much better.
Okay, super. So in South Africa, you stated that the white people are way more afraid of black people than in the reverse. Do you feel that the black people that you come in contact with have a fear for you, of you, or look at you as some kind of great white hope due to the kind of brainwashing that they've had in Africa of white people? And that's my last question. Thank you.
I think that in terms of the fear, I don't think it's... as I said, I think it's, you know, there's a lot more fear of white people towards black people than vice versa, fear and distrust. In terms of the great white hope kind of thing, I mean, there definitely is an element of that, but I find that tends to be with the older generations who probably still lived, you know, the majority of their life under apartheid and under the kind of segregation of that era. I think with a lot of the younger guys, say, for example, a lot of the guys that I spend time with and interview for articles that I'm writing about young black men who are social entrepreneurs or who have created interesting startup businesses, I definitely don't think there's any sense of a sort of great white hope from them. I mean, these guys are, you know, they're confident, they're self-assured in what they're doing, and I think they have a pretty... Yeah, they're pretty. They've got a lot of autonomy and agency, and they're not kind of waiting around for someone else to do stuff for them or to come in and save them. Absolutely not.
Thank you.
My pleasure.
Last caller, the caller at 2456. 2456, did you have a question for Mr. Clark?
Yes, I do. Thank you for taking my call, Gus, and hello to everyone on the line. And hello to the guests.
Could you speak up? Your volume's a little low.
Sorry about that. Is that better?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Thank you for taking my call, Gus, and hello to everyone on the line, and hello to the guests. I want to know, is the guest familiar with the theory of white genetic annihilation? Maybe you talked about it earlier, but I tuned in recently. Sorry if you did.
White genetic annihilation. I'm not sure I know what you mean. In what sense?
Yes, there's a theory that a child psychologist came up with. White people have a fear of being genetically annihilated by non-white people, and particularly black people, as we are the darkest people on the planet. Doesn't sound like you really know about that. I that was my question. I just wanted to know, were you familiar with that? And by
sorry to interrupt, but no, I just I wasn't really sure the way you phrased it. But no, I mean, it's definitely something that I'm aware of in a South African history, and it was in South Africa a big part of the kind of propaganda around apartheid was this idea that, you know, we need white people and black people needed to be kept separate so that they wouldn't mate, basically, and create a sort of race of bastards, as they would have been referred to then. So no, that was a big part of South Africa's history. So I could probably answer something on that. I don't know what your question was exactly.
So you that's interesting. You said they were saying that it would create a race of bastards.
Yeah.
Hmm. Okay. Well, you're dating a black woman, a woman from South Africa, who is
yes.
black, and you do know about white genetic annihilation. So you probably don't believe that, or.
I mean, I believe that it was. You know, I know that it was a theory that people believed in, but, like, you know, to me. It's not a concern that I have, and I'm luckily for me and for my partner, neither of our families, it's definitely not something that they are concerned about. And I think, yeah, you know, if and when we would have children, you know, I don't think that the fact that they are in some way, well, being mixed race, I don't see that that's in any way sort of like a bad thing, or that's the way it would be, and that's, you know, there are more and more mixed race people in the world, and I don't have a problem with that personally.
Okay, and just one more question: you have ancestry in Europe, or do you? Maybe your family's been in Africa for a long, long, long time.
No. I moved over here. Alone, my family are all still in England in the UK.
Okay. And so that was my question. Why do you think, because people have a lot of great things to say about Europe, it's beautiful, it's wonderful, it's heaven on earth. Why do you think Europeans left Europe with it being such a great part of the world? Why do you think they left Europe and started venturing out with the other people who were non-white, is what they were going to be amongst a bunch of non-white people?
I mean, I think, I don't know. I mean, I think kind of exploration has obviously been a big part of European history for a very, very, very long time. So you could argue that maybe it's just something innate to European people to sort of explore the world. I don't know, but I think also, you know, there was, I mean, talking specifically about the UK, for example, you know, it was a very, very small country. It's a little island. And I think in many ways it sort of made sense, I guess, to people at the time to go and see what else was out there. And they, because of various industrial developments and things that happened in Europe before they did in various other parts of the world, they had a sort of infrastructure to be able to do that. But I also think there was obviously an element of greed, and people wanted to go and take from other places. And then obviously when they arrived in those other places, that became the kind of overarching factor. I think initially, you know, it was maybe a certain intrigue, and then it kind of got taken over by just greed and abuse of power to kind of take everything that other people had to improve your own power. If that makes
okay.
sense.
Well, thanks. Thanks for taking the call, and thanks for coming on the couch today and teaching us more about racism, white supremacy, and what it means to be white.
Thank you.
Appreciate that from the caller. We finished all our callers. I just had a couple quick questions, and we'll let you go. I know it's late over there. It's a little after 11 p.m. your time. How did your partner, how did her parents respond to you? You said you all have been together, I guess, close to 5 years now. How was their response to their daughter dating a white man from Europe?
Well, they had no issue. Yeah, I mean, it's I don't want to go into details of the family because it's not my family. But all I'll say is they had no issue with it.
And your parents? How did your parents respond to you, you know, taking this sojourn global globetrotting and ending up in South Africa with a black girlfriend? How did your parents respond?
Equally, I don't think they ever really, in terms of having a black girlfriend, I don't think it's ever been an issue. I think it's taken them a bit of time to get used to my lifestyle in terms of just you know, living abroad and some of what are some of my views of the world, I think they consider to be a little bit outlandish. And my views on, I don't know, Britain's history and on the history of colonialism and all this kind of stuff, I think they think my views are quite radical. But in terms of having a black girlfriend, a black partner, it's never been an issue. I mean, they've never treated her any differently to anyone else I've been out with. In fact, if anything, they're definitely more fond of her than anyone else I've been out with. Not that that's in any way dictated by her race, but just because she's an awesome person. So I think I'm very lucky in that way. I think, you know, as I said, I definitely think that both my parents are in some ways slightly racist. But I think they are essentially good people, and pretty kind and open people, and they welcomed her with open arms.
And you said you all have been together 4+ years at this point. I mean, is this moving towards marriage and having children? I mean, how serious is this? 4 years seems like a pretty lengthy commitment.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, it's something we're talking about. You know, neither of us in a hurry. And I think we're both quite career driven, and, you know, have things that we want to achieve, sort of on our own, and not to be sort of, not the marriage necessarily has to be a sort of hindrance on things, but I think, or children. But I think that, you know, I think we want to be more sort of settled in ourselves and in our lives, both sort of individually and together before that stage. But no, I mean, I definitely think, you know, kids and marriage and all that stuff are on the cards in a few years.
Fascinating. What, I mentioned Trevor Noah at the top. Do you think it's relevant? I think I emailed this one. Do you think it's relevant? Yeah. Do you think it's part of his success, the fact that he has a white parent?
I think at least it allows him to kind of move between different spaces more easily than some other comedians and some other people, and to kind of ridicule everyone on both sides of the racial spectrum without anyone really taking offense. Or, well, obviously some people do take offense, but I think it facilitates his work and his type of comedy to a degree. I don't know if his sort of kind of rise to the top or whatever you want to call it is sort of in any way connected. I can't, obviously that would be a very kind of speculative argument, but I think I can see how it could help him, definitely. Yeah.
Do you think it's relevant, or do you think also a significant factor in his success is the fact that he does seem to be very willing to ridicule black people, both black people in South Africa and black people in the States, African Americans?
Yeah, I mean, I think it's, you know, it's a complicated one because, you know, as a comedian, you know, he ridicules everyone. I mean, he's, you know, he ridicules white people, he ridicules colored people, he ridicules black people. I should probably clarify. I know that colored has a very different meaning in America. I'm not sure how, you know, if it's a sort of common knowledge in the US. I don't know if it's common knowledge that colored is a very different thing in South Africa. But that's a conversation for another time, I suppose. But no, I think he does, you know, obviously he ridicules everyone to a degree. But I think that obviously the power dynamics possibly mean that it's different when he's ridiculing black people, in the same way that if I make fun of, let's say, like a black African guy's African accent, it doesn't have the same connotation as if he makes fun of my English accent because of the different power dynamics. So I suppose you could apply the same rule to Trevor Noah's comedy. But it's a difficult one because I think kind of in general, you know, a comedian's job is to kind of poke fun at everyone. And I don't know if I watch enough Trevor Noah to really sort of say, okay, he leans more towards poking fun at black people than he does anyone else, or is it sort of an equal balance? Should it be leaning more towards ridiculing white people if you consider the power dynamics? You know, these are some of the questions you could ask. So I think, you know, critiques and conversation around that is definitely valid. But I don't know if there's a sort of definitive answer that I can give you.
I know Wendy Todd, she's a writer. She had a piece in the Washington Post last spring. It was titled, "Yes, the New Daily Show Host is Black, and He Spent His Career Making Fun of African Americans." And she kind of goes through several years, not just a one-time thing of him doing a lot of routines that were specifically mocking black people, and black people in the States specifically, and even some of our listeners in South Africa wrote in that he had a pattern, a history of doing that sort of thing in South Africa, not about African Americans. He was just mocking black people over there for a while.
Yeah.
Then that, in conjunction with him having a white parent, a lot of folks said it made a lot of sense in a power dynamic of white supremacy, why white people would be very eager to, you know, say, hey, let's make this a marquee comedian and put him on The Daily Show, and this is the best new comedian in the business, in the world, doing routines like that. With that, I think I got to, I guess before I leave you, I think you did give us some comments when you said that your parents were kind of racist. You gave us some comments about your dad and comments he would make about crime in the paper. What specifically about your mom? What are some of the things that she done would qualify her as being kind of racist, quote unquote?
I think with my mom, it's more speculative. I don't think I can remember sort of specific instances like I can with my dad, but I just think it's probably sort of inevitable, considering the world that she grew up in. You know, she also grew up in a very wealthy, white sort of rural area where she wouldn't have been exposed to a lot of different people. And I know for a fact that her parents were racist. And in fact, in a weird twist of fate, her mother's side of the family were, a few generations back, quite major slave owners in the Caribbean. So, you know, there's definitely a history of substantial history of racism on that side, on one side of my mother's family. In fact, my great-great-grandfather was one of the strongest or one of the leading pro-slavery campaigners in the UK. So, you know, I'm sure obviously some of that stuff kind of carries across generations. But I think actually, you know, in fairness to my mum, she's quite an amazing person. She's a lawyer, and she spends a lot of time defending people who are from much lower sort of socioeconomic backgrounds or areas than she is. And I think she's generally one of the few people I know who actually does make very little judgment about anyone based on their class or anything else. And I think, you know, I said it in South Africa, but I think anywhere in the world, race and class are still kind of quite tightly bound together because of the history of kind of white supremacy and segregation and various other things. So I think maybe I was being a bit unfair to my mum. I can't think of any individual instances where she showed something that, or did something that I felt was racist.
You could be practicing racism consciously right there, Mr. Clark. I even read the post that you did about consciousness when your mom sent you the book on France Fanon. That to me seemed like an act of racism right there, where she was saying that, I guess she flipped, maybe she had read France Fanon, Black Skin, White Mask, where she said, oh, wow, you've got this lopsided perspective on things. Maybe I should have got you a book to balance things out, to make it more quote unquote fair, to give you a different perspective so you don't get this jaded view of history. In my view, that was a pretty blatant act of racism that you yourself wrote about. Am I being incorrect?
No, you're not. But I actually, subsequent to that post, my mom wrote me a very long email kind of explaining how I had, or what she'd intended to say and how I'd sort of misunderstood what she said. And I think in hindsight, you know, I can't go into the details of that email, but I think in hindsight it was a misinterpretation on my part. As to what she meant by saying that I was getting a one-sided view.
Interesting. We will leave it there. It would be grand to be able to have you come back on the program, because just this is way earlier than we normally broadcast. It's still significantly early in the day. Plus, I'm on the West Coast in the U.S. For people that are on the East Coast, I mean, it's almost evening, but out here it's still very, very early in the afternoon on Monday. So a lot of our normal listeners are not able to participate. So it would be grand to be able to have you back on the program in the future once people are able to hear this in the archives, and they'll probably have some questions that they would want to ask. And South Africa, it seems like there's always something dealing with racism that comes up and ends up being a very popular thing. So it'd be grand to be able to have you to come back and discuss things in further detail down the road. I'm sure you'll have some new writings that would be cool to discuss as well. For our listeners, if you want to check, get to the blog to see some of what Mr. Clark has written about, the post that we talked about and what have you, you can visit his website. Again, it's linked in the description. The address, www.caw.clark.com. That's all together. www.caw.clark.com. You'll see blog, his email information is there, the whole nine, so you can get more information about our guest, Mr. Christopher Clark. Grand to have you on the program. Thank you so much for sharing a bit of your Monday evening to get some of your views on a lot of different aspects. And like I said, I hope we can have you back on the program in the future, sir.
Sure thing. Thanks for having me, man. It was, gave me quite a grilling.
Fascinating, fascinating. We will be in touch, and I'll definitely be keeping an eye on your blog to see what you're writing about, sir.
Good stuff. Thanks, Gus.
Yes, sir. Take care.
Cheers. Bye.
Evening. Context of White Supremacy, our guest, Mr. Christopher Clark from South Africa. I would have given credit to the listener who recommended that we have him on the program, but I just could not recall the person who recommended him, and then I couldn't even find it in my email. People send suggestions via Twitter and Facebook and my email account, so sometimes it can become difficult to keep track of whom is doing the recommending. But whoever it was, as long as they're listening, right on. Glad we knocked that one down. We should be back tomorrow with Kathy Dang. She'll be visiting us. She is a non-white female, classified as Asian. Played a segment. She was on Democracy Now! About a month ago, maybe a little longer than that, where they were talking about the Akai Gurley shooting in New York at the end of 2014, where he was shot and killed by Peter Liang, also classified as Asian, Asian male. He was later convicted of the killing, but was given a sentence of no jail time. And there have been protests, huge numbers of Asian Americans and others protesting, saying that this is ridiculous. Different police officials saying that he shouldn't have been charged in the first place and certainly should not have received any jail time. Lots of black people have been furious with Ken Thompson, the black prosecutor in the case, and saying that this, you know, no good Negro should have charged should have recommended jail time because before the actual sentencing, Ken Thompson recommended that Mr. Liang not get jail time. But Kathy Dang, she's been speaking about this and saying that this entire incident is a great illustration, or really a tragic illustration, of white supremacy. She talked explicitly about how non-white, non-black people are used by racists to further terrorize black people and uphold white supremacy. She talked about that in detail and how non-white, non-black people need to be vocal in talking about this, talking about the ways that they are used in the system of white supremacy, being advocates for black people, and doing all that they can to support and defend black lives worldwide. She talked about that in explicit detail, and it'll be grand to hear from her tomorrow. It'll be back to our normal time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. It'll be great to have her on the program. Certainly, the incident in Florida, massive. These programs
had been scheduled like way in advance
of everything, or I probably would have stopped to take time to talk about just that specifically, but we don't really, we already had every day. I think this week is filled with programs. I think Wednesday is the only open day where we might make an effort to see if we can get on then to talk about this, but certainly that is a massive situation. So many things are important. I think I might have written, I think discussions about racism, all that stuff is going in the trash. It's going to be the war on gays, I think, is going to be the major conversation for the rest of the year and for the foreseeable future with this incident. I think it is hugely significant and not a coincidence that this happened almost a year to the day of the Charleston massacre at the Mother Emanuel AME Church last year, which was on June 17th. I think this is going to greatly displace conversation that would have been taking place about the anniversary of that. I think this is going to greatly displace that as we roll this week. I also thought, I mean, it's just so many things that are important. I also think, number one, this could be a major act of racism, because at least from what I've seen, just with the names and it being Latin night at the Club Pulse, it seems like there could have been a disproportionate number of non-white people present who were the victims of this act of terrorism. And that certainly has gotten no attention at all. I haven't seen photographs of what the victims look like, but I think that's an important aspect as well. And one of our listeners in Florida pointed that out. He was looking at some of the local Florida news coverage and saying, wow, it looks like a lot of these victims look like they could be classified as non-white. I also think hugely important, one of the things that I've been saying, just paying attention to the news about the presidential campaign, many of the political pundits who predicted, thought Hillary Clinton would win in November, they had caveats. One of their major caveats was if there was any sort of terrorist event that happened on U.S. soil between now and election time, they thought that that would be a huge boost for Donald Trump. And in fact, I heard many folks say if there is a terrorist attack on U.S. soil before election time, Donald Trump is going to win. All of that rhetoric about putting up a wall and banning Muslims from the country, that is going to resound with a huge chunk of the voting electorate, particularly if anything like that happens. And I would say that this event certainly qualifies, in my opinion. One of the first things that I saw was a lot of rhetoric about the threat of radical Islam and these Muslim terrorists, and all of that was rolling. I saw they had an article yesterday, and this was like hours after the attack, where Donald Trump was saying, see, I was right. I told you. We've been too soft. President Obama, we just had this soft Negro in the White House for the past 8 years, and he's letting folks walk all over us, and we got to be tough. We're not going to stand for this. When I get in the White House, we're not going to tolerate this sort of foolishness. We're going to show these folks who is in charge, and they're not going to be subjecting us to these sort of random acts of, you know, barbarism, just allowing, you know, President Obama to do what he wants and not be truthful about these savages. He was on a roll. I think he had a press conference as we were on the air today, Monday, June 13th. I think he's been talking about this, but absolutely, it's going to be talked about in great detail. And those are just two of the first things that popped out to me that I think are important that folks should think about, how this is going to impact the presidential election. And as I said, I think boost Donald Trump. And then I think this is going to displace a lot of conversation about white supremacy, and or is going to force a conflation that now it's going to be demanded. If we talk about racism, we have to talk about gay rights, because the worst mass shooting in the history of the United States was at a gay club. Going to be massive. Before we conclude, I will check with any of the folks who dialed in. Anybody have commentary, anything that they wanted to share about what they heard from Mr. Christopher Clark during the course of the broadcast? Certainly, if you have anything about the shooting that you wanted to share, feel free. But if any of the folks that dialed in who had a hand up should be with us, if you had any comments we wanted to share, feel free to make your voice heard.
Can I hear it?
Your volume is a little low. If you can adjust things.
Okay, how about now?
Much better.
Okay, great. To me, when I was listening to the guest, it just sounded like he, like a lot of the other Caucasian guests, they cover up for each other. They all make sure that they say just the right thing to make it seem as if they're so naive and innocent in this war. They always do that. I think even when he's in that village, when he's in South Africa interacting with the blacks, he plays the victim. He plays as if he's, oh no, not me. Oh, I didn't know that. He plays so naive, I believe, because of the way he toys around with the words and plays these games, even in that tragic relationship with the black victim he's dating. He plays those word games. That's why they're not married, because he plays a lot of games with words and, oh no, let's focus on our getting our future together. He just plays a lot of games to me, I believe, and all that naive stuff. They're not naive. He just can play those games. So that's all I wanted to say.
Yeah, 4.5 years, that seems like a lengthy courting period. Not that I'm against people if you want to get to know one another or, you know, see how things, if you all are compatible and all that. I mean, I don't have anything against that at all. But, I mean, off top, just to being a white person involved in some sort of bedroom arrangement, that is massively incorrect, massively toxic, and a huge act of racism, white supremacy. But 4.5 years, and there's no, like, you know, where is this? It's not like they're in their teens or 20s. You're 30, and you've been together for 4.5 years. Like, what are we doing here? You know, is this heading towards something? Are we just wasting time? Are we just messing around in the bedroom until you get ready to go back to Europe or move to another part of the continent? If I had to wager, I seriously doubt that they are going to get married. I'd be willing to put down a few nickels on that, a few rand on that right now, that is not going to lead to a marriage, that something will happen, career or whatever the case is, and he'll be moving along. I'm not even sure. I guess I should have asked him if he's going to be there permanently, because it seems like he's still doing some globe trotting and going different places. But I would wager that is not going to end in or conclude with a marriage and happily ever after. They have a nice house in the Bantu stands and raise their little mixed race family and all that. That would be my wager, but I could be incorrect.
Exactly. And he makes excuses for his mom, too, because when you called him out about his mom, he wasn't ready for that. So when you had to, he's like, oh, no. Well, she doesn't know my mother, because they always make, like, white women are so naive on the plantation. They just don't, you know, what's going on? I just had to deal with that big, brute, racist husband of mine for all these years. It's like, well, she was a lawyer. A lawyer? Your racist mom? Oh, no, she's a lawyer, but she worked with underprivileged people. But no, come on. And then when you read that article, it's like, well, you didn't hear what happened afterwards because it's personal, but she explained that I took it out of context. Oh, stop it. But they always defend each other. They always collectively, especially the white woman, they all merge together and protect the white woman if she's right or wrong. And then they act like, oh, the white men are just trying to protect us because we're damsel in distress. But you play that damsel in distress role because you know the order of things and you protect each other. And I won't say anything else, but I thought that was interesting.
Absolutely. You can read, if anyone is interested in reading the post where he was talking about his mom, because I don't believe there's any sort of addendum attached to that piece where he talked about his mom. He was having trouble finding a copy of Frantz Fanon's Black Skin, White Mask, and she got it for him and then was like, oh my gosh, I can't believe you're reading this incendiary, you know, Negro ramblings, and you know, you should have got something to balance things out. Exactly as you just stated, I think whites do a great job of covering and defending other white people from being indicted as a racist. And I think he did a lot of that. And that's why I think I said that earlier on in the program, that I think it's such a instructive way to learn about racism, white supremacy, when you can talk to white people in different parts of the world and see how consistent the way that they use words to obfuscate, to confuse, so that you cannot get clarity about what it means, what racism is, and how it works. It is so consistent. The use of the term white privilege, certainly I'm struggling to think of ways that I practice racism. We're ignorant. We don't know about racism. I mean, it's standard operating procedure. Even a lot of the same excuses when the tragic arrangement comes up, and this is incorrect, it's something you shouldn't be doing. A lot of the exact same justifications about this arrangement. Me, a white man, and this black female, we're on equal footing. There's no unequal power dynamic here. You see a lot of the same tacky excuses and nonsense, illogical ramblings, rantings that you've heard from white people here in the States, which in my view just further solidifies that they're not ignorant. That, I mean, it really, to me, seems very much as though whites have a code book, a racist code book that they are going by, where they get, these are things you say, these are things you don't say, these are words you use, these are words that you don't use, when you, particularly if you're going to be talking about racism with some Kaffirs, some Negros, this is the way that you talk about it so that you can confuse them and you can control how the conversation is going to go. It seems extremely obvious to me, whether it is deliberate as they sit down and have conversations about this, or whether they have books, or whether they have discussions about this, that sort of thing is happening, where whites worldwide get codified about how they practice racism just in the way that they talk and use words to discuss this and keep us confused.
Other folks, if you all had commentary, you should be with us as well. Anybody else have commentary they wanted to get in?
Hello, can I be heard?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah, I think that was like a major act of racism when he was, basically, he was coming across like he was not sure if he was racist or not. Yeah, you, because I'm driving. I'm sorry, I have to be concentrated. I'm sorry. Yeah, and he was playing the victim. When you asked him the question about how you practice racism, he was not, you know, you gave him the definition of racism, of, you know, you have to mistreat somebody. And he was just talking about ideas of people and not talking about how you mistreated people, only to find out that he's in a relationship with a black person, which is a major act of racism. He was just, you know, a good-meaning white person. That's the worst kind of white person. That's the most despicable kind of white person is. Yeah, that guy was a racist. That's all I have to say. Thank you.
The well-meaning white person worldwide. That another pat. I think we've had a lot of quote-unquote well-meaning whites on the program. I thought that was especially insidious, in my opinion, because I think particularly non-white people that are more confused, you ask a white person how they practice racism, and they begin their response with, I was robbed by a black person, and I subsequently thought that black people, I was afraid of black people. I think a high number of black people, they would probably respond. I'm not saying all, but a high number of black people, non-white people in total, I think they would respond in some way, shape, form. That's only natural. That's human nature. I'm scared of black people too. I would be afraid if a black person robbed me. You weren't robbed by, exactly as I was explaining to him. And it's white victim. They are so good at that. That's one of the standard ways, in my view, that they practice racism. Whites are victims. We are the victims, constantly having you thinking of us as victims, and typically victims of some sort of Negro violation. In my opinion, that is huge, right? That's the first and one of really the only examples of how you practice racism that you can cite. I was robbed by a black person, and subsequently that impacted my view and had me be fearful of South African Negroes. That is extremely refined, in my way, in my view, way of practicing racism. Victim, be safe if you're driving. Be safe if you're driving. I know sometimes the enforcement officers, they can pull you over for that if they see you're on the phone in certain parts of the world. The person, victim, did you have a commentary you wanted to add, sir, ma'am?
Yes, I did. I really wanted to. I didn't get a chance to listen to the whole broadcast, or really any of it, but I did want to comment on the club shooting in Orlando, and analysis of it was pretty much the same as mine. It's like, this is just going to be used to cover up. It's going to be used to practice of racism more against, Muslims or people of Arab descent, but it's basically gonna, you know, not gonna allow for racism against, that's being practiced against black people, which is the most common type of racism. It's not gonna be discussed at all. It's gonna be, you know, kind of overwritten, so to speak. So, 50 people or whatever, 49 people were killed. So, you know, that murderer that happened, the murderer that went down to South Carolina is going to be overridden. So the numbers weren't good enough. It's all about protecting, you know, gay rights and stuff. So racism would definitely be put in the back burner. And it's just, I don't know. I just hope people are really seeing this trend or this pattern. And it's very shaking. You know, I just really hope people are really paying attention and understanding what's going on. But that's all I have for right now. Thank you.
For sure. The person
4950, you should be with us as well. Did you have a comment you wanted to get in?
Yeah, I think there was a guest on before, a female, who said basically the same thing, that she was robbed by a black male, and then that's when her her racism became activated. And I noticed something too. Another pattern is that they always say, "I like to think," like they're not sure if they're racist or not. Like he said, "I like to think that I'm not racist," but like he never said either yes or no. And sometimes I notice that they never give a direct answer. They always say, "Well, I like to think," and then they'll spiral off and like try to confuse you. They'll throw in a story here and there, and then I guess as time goes on, they think that some people will forget about it. I was going to bring that up, but a few people brought that up, so that was pretty good too. But then lastly, I think that he was just being dishonest, because a lot of the things that he said, it wasn't straightforward, or again, it seemed like he was just making up random stuff just to like get us off the topic or the question that was asked. And that's pretty much it.
That's pretty standard. I think he said, because I think that came up a couple times about him being racist. I think he did say, no, currently, I am not a racist. There's good, I don't know if folks on there remember when he was asked about that. Do folks remember him saying, no, I am not a racist?
I remember him saying that.
Oh, wow. I didn't hear that. I heard him say, I like to think that I'm not a racist. And I thought that was interesting.
I think he said that, too.
Yeah, he said both those things. I'm sorry. He said both those things.
Oh, wow. Okay.
Yeah, I think he did give a lot of the buckets of words would have definitely been appropriate here as well. But I think he did, in all of the rambling, say no. He was not currently a racist, even though he might have white privilege and some stereotypes that he doesn't know about unknowingly, that sort of thing. I think that, which is pretty standard as well. I'm not a racist. I benefit from racism. Yes, and unknowingly, I might have some stereotypes or some thoughts, but no actions. There's nothing that I do as a white man to practice racism, even being with my black partner here in South Africa. Incidentally, he even has a whole blog post where he talks about white people coming to South Africa for sexual exploits, and distancing himself and saying that I am not of that, even though I see a lot of this happening. Folks want to check that out. He has a whole blog post talking about that.
I think it was a while back that I had sent you, it was like a YouTube video of a lot of people coming from Europe specifically to have sex with black males on the continent. It was pretty much a few months ago. I'll see if I can find it on YouTube again, and I'll resend it.
Widespread, worldwide, Caribbean, white men, white women, that is major activity in the system of whites here in the U.S. as well. Long-running affair, whites looking to find their different regions of dark folks that they can take advantage of sexually. The person at 9516, did you have something you wanted to add?
Well, I just called in. I didn't really hear any of the conversation, but I guess the guest on the show was talking about the truth and reconciliation. So I guess I wanted to know what was his views on that? Did he say where that there were any improvements 20 years later involving that?
We didn't spend as much time on that. At first, I thought that Mr. Clark, that's the guest, Christopher Clark, I thought he was born in South Africa, but that is not the case. He's only been in South Africa for a few years. He was born in Europe. So
I didn't focus as much on that because I didn't think it was be as salient to him, since he's not someone who's grown up in South Africa and lived in all of this and the changes and everything, even though he is there now. And they are, with the 20-year anniversary, they are focusing a lot on what's, you know, changed over the last two decades since the Truth and Reconciliation Commission. I think he did acknowledge that there's, I mean, obvious, still widespread disparity. We are in a system of white supremacy. He agreed with my definition. But I think we focused more of the conversation just on his assessment of racism in South Africa, him being sexually involved with a black female in South Africa, the work that he alleges to do that is supposed to be anti-racist or against racism in South Africa, if he is a racist, why or why not he said no, even though he, you know, said he, standard answer you hear from whites, he has white privilege and unconscious bias, he was robbed by a black person and ended up being afraid of black people. Those are some of the things that we focused on in the interview, not so much the 20-year anniversary of the TRC, even though that is important, just because, as I said, he's not from there, so I didn't think it would be as salient to him.
Oh, okay. Well, I was just wondering that. Thank you.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Caller in Michigan, did you have commentary you wanted to add?
I found it interesting that the guest thanked you, you know, for, I guess, the challenging questions. To me, it seems interesting how some of the white people that come on the show, you know, I don't know if they take it as, you know, they're being educated or I don't know. I just thought it was interesting how he, you know, the chuckling in between some of the questions. And then he did want to thank you for, you know, asking, you know, these tough questions that I guess he's not used to. So I don't know what he plans on doing with that, but maybe, you know, help him in his refinement. But I thought the chuckling was, you know, standard. And once again, it's interesting how so many of the guests, the white guests, or just the guest period for the most part, have no issue with saying that white people are most confused. And it's ludicrous. So it was interesting. And that's all I wanted to share.
Yeah, I think for him specifically, I think it's got to be that white people are most confused, because if not, then we might be, I think it would, you would be right on the doorstep of, well, my girlfriend has to be confused. If white people are not most confused, if black people are most confused, then I am most certainly taking advantage of someone who is quite mixed up about racism because they have been messing around with me for 4 years. They have a vested interest in propagating that, you know, in my opinion, extremely dangerous, obvious lie. And I do think, in terms of refining their code, I do think for some of the whites who have come here, oh, yeah, thank you all so much. It's been such a rigorous, I think he said grilled, as with a chuckle as he left. And I think I was muted, but I laughed. It's like, what are you talking about? Like, you got asked a few questions by some, you know, niggers on the other side of the world. Like, what are you even talking about? Like, this has no impact on you at all. This is not making your life any more difficult. You can go off and enjoy the rest of your evening. Go have intercourse with your black partner if you are so interested, or whatever else you want to do with your time and energy. Like, this is, in my opinion, I think they try to give the impression as though this has been some sort of difficult experience for them. And nothing could be further from the truth. As you said, I think they just take this in. Alter their code, upgrade the way that they deal with niggers in case they bump into some black people that are a little bit more suspicious than what they're accustomed to, so that they can be a bit better prepared for how they respond in the future.
I just wanted to comment what you just said, Gus, that was right and exact. I think a lot of the guests, the white guests, will use cows as a way to do some, I don't know how to really say it. I don't want to say steel sharpening, because that's a metaphor, but just use it as a way to maybe get sharper on how they can talk to a black person or a victim that might not be, you know, they might be more knowledgeable about what's going on, and so they can come to CALS where the people are more knowledgeable, and then they can get, I don't know, information to maybe talk more slick to them. And he did do a lot of laughing, so I just, when they get to doing all that giggling and that, they're just practicing racism, and that's how I felt about it. I'm like, he's doing a lot of giggling, and I just feel like they come on the CALS to get more information on how to deal with a more knowledgeable victim on what's going on around us.
Yeah, I do notice that most of the white guests, they do laugh a lot, but I think that having those guests on the show helps victims to see exactly how white people are, so they won't be so confused about what they really think and how they really are. So this is why I really enjoy listening to the show, and then listening to them talk, so it can help me to be more codified when I have to deal with them.
And I also wanted to add to that, I heard Mr. Fuller say that, you know, the codification that he has introduced, I guess, you know, he specifically said it does not work on or for white people. And I didn't understand that at first, but the more and more I listen to the guests, the white guests, or just my interactions with white people, and I find myself, you know, just, you know, being specific with my words and using, you know, just asking questions and being more codified. You know, it's just interesting how it shakes them, or it just makes them uncomfortable. So it's the white guests that you have are, you know, the ones who call themselves trying to be honest, I guess. it's just more and more evidence that doesn't matter who they are, what I see, they're racist, and they try their best to try to hide it and, you know, act like they're the good white ones and things like that, but it's just obvious that it's their culture. So that's all I wanted to add.
I thought it was significant when we were having the exchange about the incorrectness of sexual intercourse, when he said, I forget the exact phrasing, but it was something to the effect of, I've kind of lost my train of thought, or I was taken aback at you using the Nazi comparison, like comparing me to a Nazi, like that's not what it is. That is exactly what this is on a global scale. I mean, they might not be shoving Negroes in ovens on a daily basis, but he even admitted, like, yes, this is massive violence against black people worldwide every day that white people like he and others, his parents, and I would include in that as well, that's what they're engaged in. And as the caller stated, there's no way for us to pick out if there even is such a thing as a good white person. I did have that as a question to ask. If there is such a thing as a white person who is not racist, there's really no way for us to pick out who these individuals are. And I just come back, no such person even exists. That is hogwash to begin with. That is an act of racism, even submitting that there is such a person in the first place. But at any rate, I thought that was extremely important. And even, because I mean, then once that came up, that's when I thought, like, it just, the nonsense was really rolling at that point, because then it became, well, we're on equal footing. Racism, white supremacy does not apply within the dynamics of our arrangement. Me as a white man and she as a black female, there is no unequal power differential. And I mean, even that sort of thing right there, I would hope people just think about that now. With a straight face, you're saying that and asking me to accept that. Yeah, and you, the whole premise of his blog is me being honest. I'm a white man talking about this. I'm a white man. I can go in the ghettos, in the Bantustans, in the shanty towns of South Africa at 5 o'clock in the morning by myself, no security, no guns, and, you know, I'm not robbed. I'm not under danger or threat. It's like, oh, wow, a white man with a camera. Wow, and they're treated nice and welcomed with open arms, but there's no difference between you and a black female. Like, total nonsense. And the only thing I would encourage people, if you're newer listeners or people, if you just started to understand racism, white supremacy, I think sometimes it can be difficult to recognize when white people are just lying, when they are just saying things that are that make absolutely no sense at all. And that would be one right there. I think he gave quite a few, but that certainly underline, highlight his entire exchange, in my opinion, around the sexual intercourse and why that's incorrect. Lots and lots of just total nonsense, things that make no sense at all, and just unwilling to acknowledge, yes, this is just more of the same in terms of practicing racism, white supremacy. And even I've heard that before, where they try and say that this is suggesting that my partner has no agency. I've heard that same rhetoric before, that, you know, you're denying her agency, or you're just assuming that she's, you know, been duped, that she's just some, you know, ignorant person and doesn't understand what's going on. Yes, that tends to happen to us non-white people. It's not disparaging of her, but that does tend to happen in the system of white supremacy, where black people, non-white people, where we do get fooled regularly by white people in all manners, not just sexually, but in all manners of people activity, where regularly white people are able to fool us, take advantage of us, and we don't figure things out until way down the road, if at all.
And that the young lady that he's dating too, I mean, he obviously he tricked and fooled her, because he told us that when they were first dating, she was very suspicious of him, and I can imagine that she was, being in South Africa. But that doesn't even matter. I mean, here in America, I would never. And I'm in Iowa, and I've been suspicious of white people. My grandmother and my granddaddy sat me down and gave me the business about white people. So I wonder what did he tell her to quell her suspicions. But yeah, he said she was very suspicious at first.
I don't think it could have been too suspicious if he if they had been together for 4 years. It was not sufficiently suspicious, which has been my case generally. We are not nearly suspicious enough of white people, and it just doesn't take very much, because he says she's doing plays or writing or whatever project she's engaged in that directly address white supremacy. It's just been my experience that even those people, we just do not have an adequate understanding of white people, and that it generally does not take very much for a white person to come along. And, you know, I read Frantz Fanon, I read Steve Biko, and, you know, I read Chinua Achebe, rattle off some more authors and places that you've been, and I'm working on this project and doing a documentary and blah, 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 and whatever. It's just been my experience that it does not take very much to allay those suspicions. In fact, it reminded me of Gillian Shute. That's a white woman in South Africa who also, she's in the same vein, who alleges to be working against racism. She's in a sexual relationship. She's married and has a son with a black male who was in the same prison on Robben's Island as Madiba. I don't know if they were there at the same time, but he was working against apartheid in South Africa. He's older. He does documentary films about racism in South Africa, and they're married. They're together. Same thing. It seems she was able to successfully allay his suspicions, and they're together. They've been married, and as I said, have a son. She's been on the program a couple. In fact, they were both together on the program after the passing of Madiba. I believe that was towards the end of 2013. But yeah, it's been my experience. Whites are very, very good at duping us, at tricking us. Even those of us who are a little bit more informed about racism, we are obviously not informed enough.
I agree.
The caller 5992, did you have commentary you wanted to add? 5992.
No, but I'm just listening to what you guys are saying, and it all makes sense. I'm just listening. Thank you.
For sure. Anything else folks wanted to get in? Anything didn't stand out, or question you wish you had asked, or something you wanted to detail before we wrap things up? Or the shooting related as well. I know that's major event, in my opinion, going to be one of the top five events of the year, the shooting in Orlando. Everyone satisfied?
I'll put in something quickly. They said they had talked to him before, and a lot of times they'll say that, like, you know, this person has went on a shooting spree, and we brought him into the office here a couple years back, and then we let them go, and then they end up doing something. So I don't know. I mean, are they sending the people out? I wouldn't put anything past them. Maybe they're sending them out to do it. I don't know.
I know that certainly. I'm sure some people had been thinking that. I know people have raised that when that, because that has happened before, people that they've had previous contact with under suspicion that this person might, you know, do something, that has come up before, and then they get released, and then they end up going out and being involved in a serious shooting. I know at least from information that I've seen so far, I was curious as to how he got in the club to begin with all of these firearms, because they had security at the club. And I know that was even, people were asking about that on the news, that they were not sure how he got into the club to begin with. Did he shoot his way in? Was he able to get by security with all of these guns? Like, how would one have done that with all of these weapons? And they were saying that it seemed like he had a pretty massive amount of ammunition as well. So how would he have been able to get into the club past security without them being aware of all of this? Or, you know, as they said, did he just shoot his way into the club? More questions than answers at this point. I can only say that regardless, I think as Mr. Fuller has said, the people that are most to blame, I would submit, racist man, racist woman, racist child, and the people that I think are going to be able to most successfully utilize this event for their benefit are certainly going to be the white supremacists. And I've already detailed two of the ways that I think this is going to go. Number one, easily be able to displace conversation about racism, particularly the Charleston incident, because I think that was going to be a huge bit of conversation for this week, people talking about the one-year anniversary of that and the death penalty. Now either it's not going to be talked about at all, or it's going to have to be connected to this and how the war on gays should be included in this, because it's not just racism. And two, I think Donald Trump is going to be a huge beneficiary of this. I didn't get to hear his speech from today. I'll check that out once we go off the air. But as I've said, that's one of the things I've heard all year long, even from people that are supporting Hillary Clinton and people that predicted that she was going to win. They said if anything like this shooting took place on U.S. soil, they thought Donald Trump would win, that they thought a huge section of people would switch and vote for him based on this. And everything that I've seen over the past 24 hours would support that. So we'll have to see how things evolve. But huge event. We'll have time to talk about it more over the next few days and what have you. But maybe we'll even see what Kathy Dang thinks about all this tomorrow. But I definitely think this is going to be something that racist white supremacists hop on and use. If they did not orchestrate and conduct this themselves, directly, indirectly, they certainly are going to use this to strengthen their system. Everyone satisfied?
I just had a quick question. What time are you on tomorrow?
Normal time, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific.
All right, groovy. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Folks, content? Everyone content?
Yes, sir. Have you heard?
Yes, sir.
Quick question. I was just wondering, has anyone else noticed that they keep saying that he allegedly is a part of the ISIS group? And I'm wondering, they say that pretty often. And where I'm from, they have gangs. Was it Prince? But, like, it's so easy for someone to say, hey, I'm affiliated with this group, and not really be affiliated with this group. And then they also said that he said this on a 911 call. Normally, when someone calls in, they'll play it on CNN and stuff like that. I didn't see any of that on CNN where they planned a 911 call of what he actually said. So I was wondering if anyone noticed that they keep saying he's a part of this group, and if anyone also heard the 911 call.
I didn't hear the 911 call, but I certainly have heard or read and, you know, seen people saying that he was affiliated with ISIS, that he claimed that he admitted some sort of affiliation with ISIS, but I have not heard a 911 recording where he's admitting this himself. I have not heard that. And even I think the first place that I heard this, I think, was NPR. And I would encourage people that want to do some research, I would encourage what Dr. Rasayan said. He'll be on the program next week in terms of triangulating your news sources. So check a lot of different sites to see what people are saying. Maybe check Alex Jones. You can check the Washington Post and the New York Times. Check Al Jazeera. Check some of the foreign sites. Go to France 24, the BBC. Check some independent bloggers, see what they're saying. Check some of the local news sites down in Florida, the Orlando Sentinel or some other sites that are local news outlets, to see what they're saying. That way you can take a conglomerate of different sources and you might get a better assessment, because I'm sure some sites will have information and or they'll have sources and what have you that other places don't have. I know I checked BBC yesterday and some other places, and there were some differences. I noticed some sites, they were playing up the gay aspect more than others. I know when I heard NPR, they were not even branding this in affiliation with ISIS. They were saying that they didn't have information to even confirm that at this point. They were just saying more. They were calling it an act of terrorism, but they were not willing to say that this was in any way connected to ISIS or anything like that, that they just didn't have information to support that. They didn't know if it was specifically targeting these individuals because they were gay. They didn't have any information to support that at all. So this is NPR. They were hesitant about even making any of those claims and being very explicit about that. Other sites that I saw, they didn't take that approach at all. They were just like, yeah, this guy's with ISIS. This was a terrorist attack and blah, 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 blah. And, you know, his dad, I saw some sites where they said his dad had said that he saw some gay people kissing, I guess, and that enraged him because he was with his son when he saw this, and you know, that's why he did it. So it's just been interesting in terms of the angle that different folks have taken and how they have covered all this. That's why I said if you check different sites to kind of see what they're saying, that might be interesting as well. I'm particularly interested in when they give the photos of what these people look like eventually. That will be interesting information as well, in terms of how dark these people are. Are these individuals that would be classified as white or non-white? I think that's important information for all this as well. But yeah, that's my response. If anybody else wanted to respond to that question in terms of the 911 call or what they've heard in terms of the suspected shooter in this case.
I've heard the same thing that they said. It was a person called in. They did a mass shooting at a gay club, and then they went to the telephone or had a cell phone or whatever, called the police, 911. I mean, I'm trying to figure out how did it go. I want to hear that call, too. I just killed people, and I'm with ISIS. I don't know how the phone call went, but I heard the exact same thing, yes.
I have a question really quick. I haven't been really following this story like I should. Is this the shooter? Did he commit suicide? Was it a murder-suicide, or is he in custody, or what's the story?
I believe he's deceased. At least the reports that I've seen, they said that they sent in a SWAT team eventually. They waited a few hours after the initial gun battle and everything started. They decided that they were going to go in and attack to try to save lives, and that he was shot by the SWAT team when they eventually went into the club, Pulse, the name of this gay club in Orlando. This would be early Sunday morning when this happened, but that he is deceased, that he died in a gun battle.
Okay, thank you.
We certainly will be talking more about this. I was very much looking for, as I said, and that is huge. I cannot emphasize that enough, that for the timing of this happening nearly a year to the date of the Charleston shooting, because that was something that I wanted to talk about this week, and, you know, kind of go back and rebroadcast what Dr. Welsing had to say about all this. Talk about loss. To be able to hear her thoughts on the timing of this happening now, at this moment, at this week, when people are already talking about that. And as I said, I am certain that is going to be displaced, or at minimum is going to be greatly altered to make sure that we include this and include our gay brothers and sisters in all of this. And they're going to just tie, I've already seen it, they're going to tie into that. Oh, all these bathroom bills and everything else is just total war on gay people. And I can only say nothing is further from the truth. In my opinion, there's one war on this planet, that is the war of white supremacy, and that white people, they have heavily invested in confusing that to add as much as they can to distract from that. This is going to be a major part of that effort. Not that I'm this, in my view, total act of terrorism. Certainly you do not, I do not encourage people just going out and shooting up folks. And I think it seems like it could have been that this was a lot of non-white people who were harmed in this. So, I mean, this totally incorrect all the way around. Just I can see how white supremacists are going to use this event for their purposes to further add confusion about what racism is, how it works. That is the main takeaway point. But again, we'll have time to discuss all of this as more information comes out. Maybe they will produce the 9/11 call at some point over the next few hours or days, and we can talk about that as well. But we should be here tomorrow, 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific. Kathy Dang, Asian female, we'll be talking about the Peter Ying shooting of Akai Early, him killing Akai Early, 2014, and how racism, white supremacy uses non-white, non-black people in order to uphold the system. Looking forward to hearing her comments tomorrow evening. If folks have questions, comments, gripes, complaints, guest suggestions, feel free to drop an email, untiljustice@gmail.com. untiljustice@gmail.com. We'll try to be responsive. If you can't find something in the archives, just let us know, and we'll try to seek it out. If it's a guest suggestion, we'll try to make time for that as well. Invest if you think the program is constructive. racism-notes.blogspot.com. racism-notes.blogspot.com. Listener-supported counter-racist radio. Thanks to all the folks who have invested. Our PayPal button is in the top right corner of the blog. If you're not in a PayPal, drop us an email. We'll get you a physical mailing address. And again, just huge thanks to all the folks who have helped keep us on the air for 7+ years. With that, we will wrap things up. Again, I encourage sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. I am sure that at least, at minimum, this incident with the club further emphasize sobriety would be best under conditions of white terrorism. This is what we have, a global planet where this sort of mass violence, direct violence, whether it's this, the water being poisoned in Flint, it's just, that's what you just have, perpetual cycles of violence, particularly targeting dark people, black people, non-white people in total, but especially dark people. You really want to make sure that you are clear thinking so you can make the best possible decisions to keep yourself as safe as possible under conditions of total terrorism. Certainly if you're going to be out and about in a vehicle, do everything that you can to not be under the influence. You do not want to make race soldiers' job any easier than it already is. If you're a driver, passenger, pedestrian, buckle up, and let's just do everything we can to minimize contact with these enforcement officers to begin with. That said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. It has been time. Replace white supremacy with justice immediately. Cal signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.
Nigga, you so brainwashed.
I'm a victim, your brother.
Problem. You're a victim.
I'm a victim of 400 years of conditioning.
Shut up.
The man has programmed my condition. Mm-hmm. Even my conditioning has been conditioned.